Yeah, I was gonna do this whole big title crawl thing with the music and all that, but I'd rather not get hit by a copyright strike. So you should just imagine there's one, all right? Anyways, welcome to another iceberg. Today, it's about my favorite franchise of all time, Star Wars. This franchise means a ton to me, so I want to do something a little different. Instead of each tier being more and more obscure, each tier now has a different topic. The first tier being highlighting stuff in the fandom, second being canceled projects and cut content. The third being weird stuff in both Legends and Canon's EUs, fourth being behind the scenes stuff and Easter eggs, and the fifth tier being just random stuff that I couldn't really fit into any other category. Oh, and one more thing before we begin. If you consider yourself part of the fandom menace, please stop watching the video and fuck off, because I want nothing to do with you people. Go harass minority groups someplace else. This video and channel are a place where toxicity of any kind are not allowed. So, with that being said, on with the video. Pink 5 is a fan film released in 2002, written and directed by Trey Stokes, and stars Amy Earhart as Stacy, a Valley Girl type who participates in the Battle of Yavin. It spawned several sequels, like Pink 5 Strikes Back in 2004, Return of Pink 5 Volume 1 and 2 in 2006-2007, and finally Volume 3, which was released in 2013. It's an incredibly popular series of fan films that won the George Lucas Selects Award and won the 2003 Official Star Wars Fan Film Award. It's so famous that Stacy herself was made canon in the EU in Timothy Zahn's novel Allegiance. You can find all of Pink 5's installments on Amazon Video. Threads of Destiny is a full-on Star Wars fan film that's 110 minutes long. It was directed by Rasmus Tirzitis and released in 2014 with a budget of between $5,500 and $6,000. It's about a new era of Star Wars and set 94 years after Return of the Jedi. The peace in the galaxy is interrupted by the ancient Skinniv Empire. It's pretty popular among Star Wars fans, but in 2017 it was removed off of YouTube for copyright because they used music from the movie. Oh wait, no, they didn't. The film had an original soundtrack. Okay, Disney. Anyways, two scripts for two sequels have been made, but since Threads of Destiny took 9 years to complete, the chances of these being two being made are slim to none. Hardware Wars is a 1978 parody of Star Wars directed by Ernie Fosfolas. It's a low-budget parody of Star Wars that came out only a year after the original, making it the first-ever Star Wars parody. It's also the most profitable short film of all time, with a budget of only $8,000 and a box office of $1 million. In 1999, George Lucas stated that it was his all-time favorite Star Wars parody, and in The Last Jedi, the scene in which the robotic steam iron is framed to resemble a landing ship, that wasn't just a joke for the film, but it was also a nod to this fan film. What a genuine king move from Rian Johnson. Star Wars Explained, originally known as Star Wars Minute, is a YouTube channel run by a man named Alex. As the name suggests, it's a Star Wars channel that makes quick explanation videos of Star Wars lore, reviews of episodes in the Clone Wars, Mandalorian, Resistance, etc., trailer breakdowns, canon updates, etc. He also streams with his wife Molly building Lego sets every once in a while, and releases a Q&A with her every Saturday. The duo have actually appeared in the Star Wars show before during Celebration, and have gotten many interviews with writers and game designers that work on Star Wars projects. They're by far my favorite Star Wars channel and are an anti-toxicity channel that I only hope continues to grow in the future. Here's some of my all-time favorite stuff from them. Fanboys is a 2009 comedy film directed by Kyle Newman, about a group of childhood friends who are all massive Star Wars fans, traveling across the country to steal a rough cut of the Phantom Menace before their friend dies of cancer. The film is notable for having some celebrity cameos like the leftist King Seth Rogen and Star Wars actors Billy Dee Williams, Ray Park, and Carrie Fisher. Is it good? Well, I haven't seen it since I was 10, so I have no idea. Chances are probably not. Vader Episode 1 Shards of the Past is a 2018 fan film directed by Danny Ramirez, about Darth Vader struggling to deal with being a Sith Lord. It featured its own score, and the film was well received by fans of Star Wars Theory, the YouTube channel that made it. Essence of the Force is a 2001 fan film directed by Pat Gerby. It's about a Jedi battling Muwi Maul, the brother of Darth Maul. What a great family. Maul, Savage, Feral, Vicious, Muwi. Anyways, they fight over a box containing the Essence of the Force. It's a really great short film that actually won Best Action Award at the 2007 Star Wars Fan Film Awards. I'd highly recommend watching it. Troops is a 1997 short film directed by Kevin Rubio, about It's basically one of the show cops about stormtroopers. It's an extremely entertaining short film that's become very popular among Star Wars fans. George Lucas himself said that he considers it canon to Star Wars, which is funny because he doesn't consider anything that wasn't the original six films or the Clone Wars canon. Sorry, Thrawn Trilogy. Weirdos online that take George Lucas' word as gospel and spoken. You can't be canon to Legends anymore. Sorry. Anyways, a semi-sequel was released in 2005 called Imps, but it wasn't a comedy. It was an in-universe show about Stormtrooper life, and it's honestly my second favorite Star Wars fan film of all time. It's outstanding from the production, to the acting, to the dialogue. It's near perfect. I'd highly recommend watching both of these films. TIE Fighter is a 2015 animated short film created by Paul Johnson that took over 4 years to make. It's a homage to 1980s anime and the 1994 TIE Fighter video game, and tells a story about the Empire and Rebels battling in space from the Imperial perspective. It's honestly the single most beautiful Star Wars fan film I've ever seen. It's insanely well made, and I cannot recommend it enough. Bucketheads, a 2018 fan film directed by Marco Busso and Andy Brown, and tells the story of a squad of stormtroopers transporting a POW being attacked by rebels. A simple premise, but executed flawlessly. This film took over 76 people to make, and its success have led the team behind it to continue the Buckethead universe by creating a series that continues the story. You can donate to the production of the series on their Patreon, which I'll link below, along with their Twitter, which you should follow for updates. I cannot wait to see what they pull off next. Eckhart Slatter is a YouTuber who primarily talks about Star Wars, but he also talks about Halo, Battlestar Galactica, and Mass Effect at times. He focuses mostly on vehicles in the Star Wars universe, with my favorite series of him being the Faction Compared series, though he also talks about lore and exposes some really shitty art theft so many Marvel artists do. He's a great Star Wars YouTuber, but my only complaint about him is he tends to trash canon a lot, which bothers me since I'm a huge canon fan, but hey, it's just his opinion. Thankfully, he's not one of those dudes who goes, "Oh, you like Rise of Skywalker. Ugh, you're retarded. You're the dumbest person I've ever met." Overall, great channel, great dude, great videos. Here are some of my favorite videos from him. Thumb Wars is a short film directed by Steve Odekirk, released in 1999, that tells the story of A New Hope, but with thumbs. It's one of many thumb parody films released around this time, and even got shown on TV in 2008. Oh, and you can buy this on VHS, DVD, and UMD. Yes, you can buy Thumb Wars for the PlayStation Portable. Imagine getting this as a gift instead of like an actual game or something. Darth Maul Apprentice is a 2016 short film directed by Sean Boo that tells the story of Darth Maul just kind of slaughtering a bunch of Jedi who land on a planet he's chilling on. The budget for this film was $25,000 and it shows. The action in this is insane, the special effects are great, the acting's great, just all around an insanely well-made short film. Easily one of the best action-based fan films in the Star Wars fan base. I highly recommend it. Ryan vs. Dorkman is a duology series of short films originally made as an entry for a lightsaber choreograph competition hosted by TheForce.net. Directed by Michael Scott and Ryan Weber, the short went viral and even got to the front page of YouTube as a featured video. God, I miss old YouTube's layout. In 2007, they released a sequel that also went viral and was even shown at the Wellshire Fine Arts Theater in Los Angeles. In regards to our third one, they said they might, but I mean, it's been 14 years. But come on, we're not going to get another one. Okay. So Jediism is a philosophy and religion created from Star Wars. It's a legal religion in the United States, and the people who actually follow this religion claim it follows the 16 teachings, such as Jedi are mindful of negative emotions which lead to the dark side, and Jedi are guardians of peace and justice. Look, I'm a huge Star Wars fan, but come on. What are you doing? Stop this. What?
Hey, you know better than that. What are you doing?
Hello Greedo is a Star Wars YouTuber who does reviews for Star Wars, but his meat and potatoes is making comedy skits, going over behind-the-scenes stuff with Star Wars, like going through deleted scenes, changes made to special editions, history to people who worked in the franchise, etc. Dude makes some great content. It's extremely anti-toxicity, and he's a really chill dude. I highly recommend his channel. Here's some of my favorite videos from him. Side note, on the day Avengers Infinity War came out, I was going to go see the movie in about an hour, and I thought, hey, he'll agree to his streaming. Check him out for a bit. Click on his stream, and he reads off a chat donation. Ooh, that was just... it's just all the deaths of Infinity War. So that was cool. That was great. In 2019, a fan named Rob Jin released a remake of the 1999 video game Star Wars Episode 1 Racer in Unreal Engine 4. It's extremely impressive. All the textures and UI are created by him, with the audio taken from the original game. It's insanely good. I don't know where to download it, but if you can find a safe download, I highly recommend it. Because we don't deserve good things, a fan-made remaster of Knights of the Republic titled KOTOR Aperion was in development for a couple of years. And if it had just been in development for just a few more months, it would have been finished and be able to play it. But, like I said, because we don't deserve good things, it wasn't meant to be. In 2018, a cease and desist was sent to the small team building the remake, Poem Studios. And the studio continued to make the game, as it could be argued that it was just a conversion mod, and you still need the base game on Steam to play it. But with lawsuits being threatened, they had to shut down. I'd recommend X2's video on the subject for more information. The 501st Legion is an international fan-based organization dedicated to the construction and wearing of screen-accurate replicas of Stormtrooper and Clone Trooper armor. It started in 1997 by Alvin Johnson and Tom Cruise, and now has over 14,000 members worldwide. Not only do they make insanely good replicas, but they also do charity events in which they never charge for an appearance. And while they're not officially affiliated with Disney or Lucasfilm, they're Lucasfilm's preferred Imperial costuming organization, and have even featured members as extras in The Mandalorian. What's crazy is that in 2004, Timothy Zahn, with Lucasfilm's approval, honored the group and made them an actual Imperial Stormtrooper unit in his novel Survivor's Quest. And finally, in 2005, the 501st Clone Legion was introduced in Revenge of the Sith, where it became mainstream. And in 2008, with the Clone Wars series, it became even more well-known. In 2000, a similar organization was created called Rebel Legion, created by Tony Troxell and Richard Fairbrother, and have over 5,000 members. They're essentially the opposite of the 501st Legion, where they dress up as Stormtroopers and clones, they dress up as Rebels, Resistance members, and Jedi. As with the 501st Legion, they also do charity events. Both these organizations are great. I have an insane amount of respect for these guys. Wikipedia is an online encyclopedia for information on the Star Wars universe. It started out in 2005 and has grown to have over 160,000 pages. It was created by Chad Barbary and Stephen Greenwood, and has articles for everything in Star Wars. What's that? You want to know more about Ahsoka Tano? Well, there you go. You want to know more about lightsabers? All right, there you go. How about those First Order transports? Boom, there you go. You want to know more about R4K5? I mean, weird choice, but yeah, he's there. Sometimes Wikipedia can get a little too weird, though. Like how there's a giant list for every time water makes an appearance or is mentioned. There's also the jizz page, and then the breast page, where just naked Adolf Secura is just casually there. Oh yeah, in 2021, Fandom, the company that hosts the site, forced them to ban dead naming. Very strange that Fandom had to step in, because like, yeah, admins on the site were like, no, we're still gonna dead name people. Luckily, two admins got permanently banned for that bigotry. And finally, Alden Ehrenreich and Felicity Jones both researched the wiki while working on their roles as Han Solo and Jyn Erso. EvanNova95 is a Star Wars YouTuber who I watched a ton of back in the day. He makes versus videos where he compares two characters and decides which of them would win in a hypothetical fight. He also does lore videos and the occasional ranking video. He's a huge fan of Legends, so he doesn't really ever cover canon stuff, sadly, but hey, that's his thing. I highly recommend his channel. Here's some of my favorite stuff from him. Movie Battles 2 is a last man standing multiplayer mod for Jedi Knight Jedi Academy. It's a heavily modified version of the game that features improvement on Jedi Academy's lightsaber combat. Basically, at the start of the match, you're either put on the light side or dark side, and have to either kill all the enemies or complete objectives. It started out in 2003, and no joke, is still extremely active, with the latest update coming out in November 2020. Spaceballs is a 1987 parody film directed by Mel Brooks that's primarily a parody of Star Wars. I loved it as a kid, and still think it holds up pretty well. Though some of the jokes are a little just too dumb for me, like the Pizza the Hut scene. But its fourth wall scene is probably one of my favorite comedy scenes of any film. It's from a cult classic, and even got a sequel animated series in 2008 that aired on G4. And, wow, let's never talk about this show ever again. What the fuck? There's also been talks of a sequel with Mel Brooks saying he wants to do it. But let's be real, there is literally no way that's going to happen. Jakku First Wave is a 2016 short film created by Benjamin Eck, and it's my favorite Star Wars fan film of all time. At only 3.5 minutes, you'd think it would just be some short action short, but oh no. It's quiet and brutally realistic, that captures the humanity of the people behind the Stormtrooper helmets. I cannot recommend this fan film enough. I refuse to say anything else about it because I refuse to spoil it for you. Battlefront updates the Star Wars gaming channel that covered BF15 news, Battlefront 2 news, and now covers LEGO Star Wars Skywalker Saga, Hunters, Jedi Fallen Order 2, and Squadron news. He also does top 5 plays of the week videos and the occasional discussion video. He's my go-to for Star Wars gaming news. I highly recommend him if you want to be kept informed. Here's some of my favorite discussion videos he's made. So this isn't going to sound super weird and cringy, but the Star Wars Battlefront subreddit was one of the most entertaining places to be if you were a Star Wars fan during the game's lifespan. The game had some of the best player-developer interactions, with Ben, Dennis, Total, and Jay all being kings having fun with the community, to the point where they all became legends in the community. They even had a community fan art wall over at Dice made up of art posted in the subreddit. Hell, when Ben left as community manager, there was a giant tribute post to him, and whenever people went, "Ben, you're the best part of DICE," he'd always respond with, "Thanks, but I'm really not. The team is filled with talented people." Mad respect for him for staying humble. Then there's memes that only OGs in the subreddit will get, like crashed speeders, some info, and the mustard troopers. I hope Battlefront 3 gets confirmed, not just because I want to play it, but I also want to experience this community again. Oh, and let's also not forget the most downvoted comment in Reddit history is on this subreddit. Shadow of the Republic is a short film made in Unreal Engine 4, released in 2020, made by the YouTuber Cinematic Captures. This guy is that was a pun. I didn't mean that. I'm sorry. Oh my god. Anyways, it's about a team of clone commandos being sent on a mission, and that's all I'm going to say, because I refuse to spoil it. It just came out a few months ago. Go check it out. It's incredible. The dude is insanely talented. He's made several Unreal short films in the past, but nothing to this extent. Currently, he's working on remastering a scene from a cut Clone Wars episode and making a VR version of Shadow of the Republic. Go check this guy out. He's insanely talented. Grocery Store Wars is a 2005 parody film created by the Organic Trade Association. It was made to promote organic foods. It has parodies such as Cuke Skywalker, Obi-Wan Kenobi, Princess Lettuce, Ham Solo, Chew Broccoli, C3 Peanuts, Tofu D2, Darth Tater, and the Egg Troopers. This is a short film. That's all I can really say about it. It exists. Also, I don't know why, but like, Ham Solo just sitting there is just... it's one of the funniest fucking things I've ever seen in my life. I don't know how else to explain it. Just look at him. What the fuck is this? I love it. From October 4th, 2007 to December 23rd, 2008, a series called The Peter Serafinowicz Show aired on BBC Two. It was a sketch comedy series that only lasted 7 episodes. In one of these episodes, it featured a skit called Darth Vader in Love, which Darth Vader attempts to seduce a female co-worker named Ada Larkin, played by Catherine Shepard. Since the short, she's actually become kind of a cult character, with fans creating their own costumes based on her. Here's hoping Ada Larkin shows up at Mandalorian Season 3. Shitty Star Wars takes in a Twitter account dedicated to calling up toxic Star Wars fans and bigoted Star Wars content creators. They're a really great account that you should follow, and before someone goes, "Well, you're self-promoting." No, I'm not an admin on this, I'm just a fan of the account. People need to call out toxic members of the fanbase. I'm tired of fandom menace bigots rolling around being the vocal minority. Star Wars fans aren't bad people, just that those people are way more vocal than the rest of us. The Lore Master is a Star Wars YouTuber who goes over lore from both legends and canon. He's a really chill dude and is against toxicity in the fanbase, so go check him out. He also makes some really great content, though I will say, this isn't a dig at you if you somehow watch this. Some of your titles kill me, like why Yoda killed his best friend, why Jar Jar Binks' father tried to kill himself, and when Mace Windu and the boys are rolled up to kill some bounty hunters. Keep making great content. Here's some of my favorite videos from him. Before Colbert's career was defined by going Orange Man Bad 24/7, Colbert did an episode of his show in 2006 where he announced the Green Screen Challenge. The challenge was to edit Colbert fighting with a lightsaber into whatever viewers wanted. After announcing the winner in a later episode, he was then killed by George Lucas with a lightsaber. May he rest in peace. Chad Vader is a 4-season-long web series created by Aaron Yanda and Matt Sloan. It's about Darth Vader, or Chad Vader. No, not that Chad Vader. Not that one. Wow, that's just not funny. That's just really not funny. It's about Chad Vader working in a supermarket and his interactions with the customers and workers there. Chad Vader was produced by Blame Society Film Productions and won several Phantom Awards. Matt Sloan, the voice of Vader, impressed Lucasfilm so much with his voice acting in this that he was made the official voice actor of Darth Vader in Star Wars video games. Since then, he's voiced Vader in both Force Unleashed games, both of the DICE Battlefront games, Soul Calibur 4, which we'll get to later, Kinect Star Wars, and even all those LEGO Star Wars miniseries. Squad 42 is a series of LEGO videos created by Gareth Pug back in the late 2000s. They tell the story of a team of clones called Squad 42, going on high-risk missions. I absolutely loved these as a kid, and was so hyped for the second installment. But it was cancelled, so never got it. Years later, in 2018, Gareth did return for one more Squad 42 mission, but instead of LEGO stop motion, it was LEGO 3D animation, and had a much darker and grittier tone. These videos will always have a special place in my heart. Star Wars Galaxy is a really obscure Czech animated series. It's only on this iceberg, so that I can archive its very existence. They released in the late 2000s and were parodies of scenes in the original six Star Wars films, along with a couple of video games. It seems that most of these have been deleted by its creator, Dalar Origins. Instead, the ones that were deleted have been re-released as new animations, despite not being new, and being rebranded as silly Star Wars animation, I assume as a way to get YouTube Kids to air them. Also, all of the prequel ones got taken down and put together as a 15-minute compilation film. I recommend watching these because you never know when they'll be taken down. They're really strange. A Clone Apart is an 8-episode web series released in the early 2010s by the YouTuber Alpha Nova. It tells the story of a clone trooper who gets sent to the future, to the time of the Empire. It's a comedy series that takes very obvious inspiration from Red vs. Blue, and it's filmed in the original Battlefront 2's engine. Surprisingly, it's held up pretty decently, and I found myself laughing during a rewatch of this video. There was a second season planned, but it's since been cancelled, so I guess the story will just never get an ending. Sith Apprentice is a 2005 short film directed by John Ede Hudkins. It's a parody of the series The Apprentice, with Palpatine filling in for Trump. One of the writers for this was Lowell Cunningham, the creator of the Men in Black comic series. But that's not the only notable aspect of this film. There's a scene in which Vader cuts off Dooku's head and hands, just like how Anakin kills Dooku in Revenge of the Sith. Despite Revenge of the Sith not coming out yet. Yeah, this film actually predates that. It also features a cameo from Amy Ehart playing Pink 5 once again. It won the Audience Choice Awards and the official Star Wars Fan Film Awards, and it's pretty funny. I'd go check it out if I were you.
Jar Jar Binks.
This is gonna show everyone how bad Misa really is.
Wicked, a Parody, is a 2018 musical parody of Star Wars and the musical Wicked. The musical's website details the play as Wicked spotlights one of George Lucas's most dubious creations, the fuzzy space teddy bear Ewoks, to explore the love-hate relationship between creators and fans, while calling Lucas to task for the racism, sexism, and maybe even sizism of the original trilogy. You can listen to the whole album on SoundCloud or purchase it yourself. If you're not convinced, track 11 is just titled Fucking Bullshit, so if that interests you, you know what to do. Star Wars Celebration is an official Star Wars convention that began in 1999 in Denver, Colorado, and has only grown over the years. Since the first Celebration event, the event has moved from Los Angeles, Chiba, Japan, Essen, Germany, Orlando, Chicago, etc. There's cosplay, panels, reveals, behind-the-scenes stuff, interviews with cast and members, life-size models of vehicles and weapons, and sometimes even early access to upcoming episodes. Sadly, the most recent celebration was canceled due to COVID, but the next one is scheduled for 2022 in California. From the early 90s all the way to the mid-2000s, there was a troll online known as Super Shadow who ran a website called Dark Side Prequel Rumors and would post fake leads to get people hyped for the prequel films. He claimed he was hired by ILM and was personal friends at George Lucas. He even did multi-part fake Q&As at George Lucas. Some of the fake leaks include Ben Kenobi would be revealed to have been a clone, Liam Neeson's character would have been Anakin's father, Episode 1 would be titled The Ways of the Force, miniatures would not be used in the prequels at all, and C-3PO contains the brain of a Jedi. Even when all this leaked were proven wrong, people continued to believe in him, which you might think is insanely silly, but we still have people like that today. Anyways, check out Hello Greta's video on the subject for way more details. Star Wars Kid is a viral video uploaded to the internet in 2003, after a 15-year-old recorded himself swinging around a golf ball retriever, pretending to be Darth Maul. The video would be discovered by a schoolmate and uploaded it online. And yeah, it's a pretty funny video, but Guy Slane Larraza, the kid in the video, was extremely bullied because of it. In 2013, he even revealed that people were telling him to kill himself, and that he had lost a bunch of his friends because of the video. He even had to leave school and get private tutoring. The story is disgusting, and I hope the best for him. Nobody deserves this kind of treatment. The People vs. George Lucas is a terrible documentary released in 2010, directed by Alexandre O. Philippi, about how George Lucas lost his way and created the prequel trilogy and the special editions of the original trilogy. Basically just saying, George Lucas is bad now. Look, I don't like the special editions or the prequel trilogy, but to make an entire documentary as to why you think that he sucks is just beyond pathetic and completely uncalled for. How people actually believe that the prequels weren't hated on is beyond me. This documentary is literally one of the biggest pieces of evidence out there. Glad to see that the Star Wars fandom has always had toxic people in it. Sadly, in 2014, it was then announced he was making a sequel that would look at the new era of Star Wars under Disney. I can pretty much guarantee you that it's just going to be, "Me no like the sequels. Disney bad. SJW Ray. Raped my childhood." Side note, if you actually claim something has raped your childhood, you're fucking pathetic.
Coming up next, it's Star Wars The Clone Wars on Cartoon Network.
A long time ago, in a galaxy far, far away.
Obi-Wan, we've got to save the Queen!
Where's her dad? Mr. Jar Jar Binks, come for comic relief.
Emergency landing on Tatooine.
No! Pod racing is with
love you, Mom.
Love you, Padme.
Oh no! Darth Maul! My brains are spilling out!
Oh joy, wind.
This is the weirdest date I've ever been on. I'm out of here.
Go you must.
Farewell.
Bye-bye.
Star Wars Episode 1 cans collect all 24 this summer.
So the original version of Episode 9 would have been directed by Colin Trevorrow and would have been called Duel of the Fates. Now a ton of concept art for this film got leaked, plus the entire script. It included stuff like the entity known as Mortis from the Clone Wars playing a part, Rey getting a double-bladed lightsaber, and also now being in a relationship with Poe, Finn leading a stormtrooper revolution on Coruscant, Kylo Ren having a vision duel with Vader, Kylo getting kind of redeemed but kind of not, Phasma executes someone in front of a massive First Order crowd, Hux kills himself with a purple lightsaber that I'm going to assume was probably meant to be Mace Windu's. Look, controversial opinion here, but I mean, yeah, I like the Finn Stormtrooper Revolution stuff. Also, side note, Lucasfilm and fans, this stuff can still be done. First Order still occupies some planets, like Coruscant, so, like, I'm just saying, a Finn Disney Plus series where it does, it could be cool. The double-blade lightsaber's cool, the vision duel's cool, but, like, Phasma still being alive? Hux's death being really weird, not just because he killed himself, but like the script goes, he lost the Star Wars, and Kylo not being redeemed are just really things I'm just not a fan of at all. Also, while Morbius being in it is cool for hardcore fans like me, it's kind of weird that it makes such a huge part of the movie tie in with just three Clone Wars episodes. Kind of makes it required reading, or watching in this case. And Rey X Poe is dumb. I'm not a Reylo fan either, but like, Rey X Poe is dumb. I just don't like it at all. Sorry. Also, real quick, I'm adding this while I'm editing the video, because there's a good chance I'll get comments about this. The reason why Coruscant hasn't been featured in Star Wars after Return of the Jedi, really, by like pretty much anything, is because originally they wanted to save Coruscant for Episode 9, and have like its reveal being like super like shocking, like it'd be like a trailer scene, like you go, wow, oh my god, there's the restored Occupied Coruscant. But since, you know, Duel of Fates got canceled, now it's just kind of like, where the fuck's Coruscant at? You know, so it's not really their fault. They were trying to hype the fans up, but still, the Finn series can still happen. Just throwing it out there. Originally, Han Solo was actually going to die in Return of the Jedi midway through the film, and Luke at the very end was going to kill Vader, take off his helmet, and put it on himself, and go, "Now I am Vader. I will go and kill the fleet, and I will rule the galaxy." This would have then led into the next trilogy, which I'll talk about later. Would this have been good? No. Not much is known about this game, but it would have starred Chewbacca as a mercenary set between Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope, and would have been created by Factor 5. Production on this didn't get too far in the early 2000s, as the strangest thing happened. It was only canceled because George Lucas himself stepped in and shut the project down. This is really weird because George Lucas almost never got involved in EU projects and didn't even consider them canon. Star Wars 1313 was an action-adventure Star Wars game that was a sort of spiritual successor to Star Wars Bounty Hunter, and would have been about a young Boba Fett making his way through the underground area of Coruscant, known as Level 1313, uncovering a criminal conspiracy. It would have been developed by LucasArts and used the Unreal 3 engine. It's become the most notable canceled Star Wars game because of its potential and its amazing E3 2012 demo. Sadly, Disney shut down LucasArts, which resulted in the game being canceled. But hey, now that EA's deal is over, maybe another company can revive this project. Star Wars The Force Unleashed 3 was the canceled final installment of the Force Unleashed trilogy. Sadly, it was canceled when Disney shut down LucasArts, but we know what the game would have been like. During a 2017 Twitch livestream featuring Sam Witwer, Hayden Blackman, and David Collins, Blackman revealed details of the third game's scrap plot. It would have been set immediately after Force Unleashed 2, and had Starkiller and Vader teaming up after crash landing on a planet, because Boba Fett shot them down. It would have been more open-world-like and had a co-op system where one player plays as Starkiller, while the other one is Vader. And finally, it would have been revealed that Fett was hired by Palpatine to stop both of them from getting off the planet because of his own scheme. Sadly, there wasn't even concept art made of this game, so the project never saw too much development. Imperial Commando was a cancelled sequel to Republic Commando, and as the name suggests, would have been focused on Imperial Commando soldiers. The game would have been about Delta Squad serving the Empire, and would eventually fought the Rebel Alliance. However, it was cancelled in 2004 despite some concept paintings being released. In 2014, LucasArts developer Brett Duvall said that the game was one of two competing designs for a sequel. Is either this, or Rebel Commando, which would have followed up on Sev's story from the first game, because if you recall, Sev went MIA at the end of the game. No. Sadly, it was cancelled because sales projections for Republic Commando were low. But don't worry, a second Republic Commando game would be released in 2005 for cell phones, called Republic Commando Order 66. Is it canon? Nope. Is it good? It's a mobile game released for phones in 2005. Star Wars Outpost was a cancelled game that would have been made by LucasArts. It was quite literally just Farmville, but with a Star Wars coat of paint. It allowed players to build their own empires and had gone through Q&A testing before being cancelled. The game was planned to be released on phones and browsers, and would have featured quote-unquote hardcore elements, such as the ability to betray other players for resources. Originally, there was going to be another Star Wars anthology film about Boba Fett, directed by Josh Trank. However, he was later fired from the project, which led to the film being reworked into The Mandalorian. Originally, it was reported that Trank had left the project over creative differences, but it was later revealed that he was flat-out fired because of his unprofessional and bizarre behavior while filming Fantastic Four 2015. or I guess Fanforstic. What a dumb name. Such behavior included arriving on the set drunk and bullying actress Kate Mara during filming to the point of tears. Luckily, now we're getting the Book of Boba Fett, which will be made without the involvement of Josh Trank. In 2018, Ian McGregor was approached to reprise the role of Obi-Wan Kenobi for an anthology film centered around Obi-Wan, set between the events of Revenge of the Sith and New Hope. And after Rogue One was a massive success, the film was put into production. But when Solo underperformed, Bob Iger decided, well, I guess nobody wants anthology films anymore, and scrapped all anthology films, including Obi-Wan's film. Despite Boris Johnson, yes, the Prime Minister Boris Johnson, revealing that Disney was shooting the film in Northern Ireland in 2018. Luckily, instead of just completely scrapping the film, they reworked it into a Disney Plus miniseries, which just means we'll get even more Obi-Wan. So at the end of the day, we can thank Solo for underperforming for this miniseries. Thanks, Solo. Hashtag make Solo 2. George Lucas had always been interested in telling Han Solo's origin. In 2005, a young Han Solo would actually appear in Revenge of the Sith, living amongst the Wookiees there, but was scrapped from the film. Later, in April 2012, only a few months before starting the company, George Lucas and Lawrence Kasdan, the band hired by George to write the screenplay for a Han Solo film, sat down and began discussing anthology films like Solo. Kasdan would later talk about this interaction by saying, and I quote, "I sat with George in April of 2012, and the company was sold in September of 2012, so it was a relatively short time before, but one of the first conversations I had creatively with George was about doing other movies than the saga films, and he had a few ideas he was kicking around with, but was very open to where this might go in the Star Wars universe. He was planning to retire. He was talking to me directly about making these films." So in a weird way, while obviously not being his story, Solo in a way is kind of George Lucas' last Star Wars film, because he directly told Disney that he had ideas for a Han Solo prequel, which probably gave Disney the idea to make a prequel, though not with George's ideas. The Jedi Knight series of games is arguably one of the most iconic Star Wars game franchises out there, with installments like Dark Forces, Jedi Knight, Jedi Outcast, and Jedi Academy. And hell, even the spin-off series of the Sith was alright. It was a very successful franchise, so many people, including myself, were confused as to why it never got more installments. Well, it almost did. While working on Jedi Academy, plans for a direct sequel to Jedi Outcast titled Jedi Knight 3 Brink of Darkness were set in motion. However, for unknown reasons, after Jedi Academy released, they just kind of dropped the game. And that's kind of it. All we know about it is that it would have told the ending of Kyle Katarn's story. That's literally all the information we have on it, unfortunately, outside of the title. Some of George Lucas's original plans for a sequel trilogy would have included elements like the films taking place 20 to 40 years after Return of the Jedi. It would have had Luke being, and I quote, on another plane of existence, or not the same character at all. R2 and 3PO being the only two to appear in all 9 films. Luke would be in a relationship with someone, and it would have dealt with the rebuilding of the Republic, introduced Luke's sister, who wasn't Leia, and the Emperor would show up in episode 9 for the first time. Ultimately, a lot of those ideas would be incorporated into the sequel trilogy, and the original trilogy. Though there's a decent chance that most of the ones that were reintroduced in the sequel trilogy were just a coincidence. But then George Lucas gave outlines to Disney for what he thought the sequel trilogy should be. These included Darth Talon corrupting Han and Leia's son to the dark side and having a master named Uber, an older Luke who would have exiled himself to a remote planet where the first Jedi Temple would be and would die at the end of episode 8, and would also be reluctant to train the new protagonist. The protagonist is going to be a 14-year-old girl. Darth Maul would return with the robotic legs and train Talon as a new apprentice and would be the quote-unquote godfather of crime. Leia rebuilds the Republic to get it under control from gangsters, and Leia ended up being the real chosen one. Outside of the Maul stuff, the Gangster Republic, Darth Talon stuff, a lot of these actually were incorporated to some extent. Oh, and he wanted to focus on the symbiotic relationship between the Jedi, the Force, midichlorians, and the Wills. The Wills being an all-powerful being mentioned in the original outline for A New Hope. The Rogue Squadron trilogy is one of the most iconic Star Wars games franchises, and was going to get at least 3 more installments, but were all cancelled for various reasons. First, there's Rogue Squadron X-Wing vs. TIE Fighter, which was going to be a launch title for the Wii, and would have been a massively multiplayer online RPG with warring factions. It was cancelled because LucasArts realized, wait, that's not possible on the Wii, we literally can't do this. Next, there's Star Wars Dark Squadrons, which would have been a spin-off to the series and focus on playing as the Empire. Sadly, this was cancelled for the Chewbacca game. That, well, you know how that ended up. And finally, there was Rogue Leader's Rogue Squadron Wii, which would have been a Master Chief collection of Rogue Squadron. It included all three of the original games ported to the Wii with new game modes and multiplayer, but was canceled because of legal issues Factor 5 had been experiencing at the time. Battle of the Sith Lords is going to be an action game developed by Redfly Studios, starring Darth Maul, or a clone of Maul, or a descendant of Maul. You see, this is one of the rare instances where George Lucas stepped into some EU stories. Because they were working on Maul coming back from the grave of the Clone Wars at the time, George told Redfly that he was interested in the game being about Maul, working with Darth Talon. And when he was told that's literally impossible because Darth Talon lived almost 200 years after Maul, he said it could be the descendant, or clone of Maul. So the story ultimately went down to this. The game would have been about Darth Maul and Darth Talon battling Darth Krayt in the Sith army, 200 years after the events of, you know, the prequel trilogy. Which, don't worry, I'll discuss these characters in detail later in the video. Also, Savage Opress and Pre Vizsla were going to be involved to some extent, despite them both being dead. Despite all the development of this game being done, LucasArts just stopped talking to them, and then just emailed them going, "Yo, stop working the game. It's canceled." Developers claim this was because Disney purchased Lucasfilm and LucasArts, but this was in 2011, so it was a bit before that. And in 2015, Redfly tried to resurrect the game, but since it's been 6 years, I can only assume that resurrection didn't go too well. So get this. Instead of a sequel trilogy of films, there was a point in the mid-2000s where a trilogy of video games would have been the sequel trilogy. Titled Episode 7, Shadows of the Sith, this would have been a third-person action-adventure game where players would play as Ben Skywalker, the son of Luke and Mara Jade, and would defeat Darth Titus, his cousin. So basically, think of the Legacy of the Force novel series, but as a video game. You'd be able to use Force powers never before seen in the films or games, and would have had Ben Skywalker using both the light side and dark side. This game was quickly shut down, however, and ideas from it would be reused in The Force Unleashed, 1313, Battle of the Sith Lords, and Star Wars Underworld, which we'll talk about a little bit later. So some people like to compare the Battlefront games to the Battlefield franchise because of the vehicles and stuff. Which, I mean, fair enough, I do too. But if Battlefront is like Battlefield, then Star Wars First Assault would have been like Call of Duty in comparison. Star Wars First Assault was a first-person shooter set for release in the early 2010s, but was cancelled due to the closure of LucasArts, and would have used the Unreal Engine. It would have been a spiritual successor to the original Battlefront games, but with more of a focus on infantry combat. Knights of the Old Republic 3 was the cancelled third installment in the Knights of the Old Republic series. According to designer John Stafford, "We got quite a bit of traction. We wrote the story, designed most of the environments and worlds, and many of the quests, characters, and items. However, the game was just starting to get into development when it was cancelled due to LucasArts being in serious trouble at the time. Later, the game would be described even more as, and I quote, the third game involved you as the player character following where Revan went and taking the battle to the really ancient Sith Lords who were far more terrifying than the Darths that showed up before. These guys would just be monsters. These would have a level of power that was considerable, but at the same time, you'd be able to dig more into their psychologies and their personalities, their history, and even how they dealt with the player, how they talked with the player, the different powers they cultivated and developed, and for some of them, like, they're like the ancients. So the places you travel to, you'd see how they left their stamp on that world, or the solar system, or whatever collection of moons. You'd see how horrible that was. Part of the environment would tell a story that would be great. An epic way to end the trilogy. Five of the planets that were meant to be in the game were Coruscant, Mandalore, Rodia, Bespin, and Talaray. Alright, I'll just be flat out real with you guys here. There is so much to talk about here. Go check out Gamer's video on the subject. With all that being said, Battlefront 3 was going to include a full-on campaign with its own unique story instead of the narration cutscenes campaigns of the last two games. It would have also featured seamless transitions from ground battles to space battles. But it was ultimately cancelled in October 2008 for a multitude of reasons that came from Free Radical and LucasArts just not getting along, not being able to work together very well. At the time of the game's cancellation, the game was literally 97 to 98% complete. It's a real shame this game was never released because... Oh wait, no, it was released. Yeah, Star Wars Battlefront Elite Squadron on the PSP is quite literally just the PSP port of Battlefront 3. It features the ground to space combat, the exact same story I was being told in Battlefront 3 with all the voice acting being ported over, and direct ports of many of the game's multiplayer maps. Seriously, if you want to play Battlefront 3, either play one of those recreation mods for Battlefront 2, or just play Elite Squadron. But this wasn't the only cancelled Battlefront game. At the time of this game being made, there was concept art being developed for a fourth installment. This fourth installment, Battlefront 4, would have had a focus on alternate universes, with Jedi versions of Vader and Maul, and Sith versions of Luke and Obi-Wan as playable heroes and villains. Other plot points from this game involved timelines where Anakin killed Yoda on Naboo, and killed Padme in a fit of rage. If you want to go around and look at everything that was in both these canceled games, go check out the free Radical Archive linked in the description, as it includes details on the gameplay, weapons, heroes, vehicles, plots, customization, etc. of both of these canceled games. Alright, so Battlefront 2 was killed by EA in order to get more people to work on Battlefield 6. It's a shame, and I hope Battlefield 6 is good, but man, do I wish they got to continue working on the game. We don't know too much about what they intended for the future of the game, but we have some ideas. For starters, there's the audio files in the game's code where Grievous mentions Padme and Ahsoka. These are more likely just recorded in case they had time to add these characters. Also, there was Subinfo, an extremely reliable leaker, who may or may not have been part of the DICE team, who mentioned how Ventress was coming to the game as well as a counter to Ahsoka. Also, there was apparently code in the files mentioning, like, a skin for Jyn Erso with, like, a hood or something like that. But the code was at the beginning of the game's launch, so it was probably just scrap content, if it was even really a thing. Seriously, I remember seeing this all the way back in 2017 on the subreddit, but I can't find anything about it. I can't find the original thread. I don't know if this was real or not. I'm just throwing it out there. The only thing we know for an absolute fact, however, is that the original trilogy era was going to get a proper Capital Supremacy mode, just like the prequels and sequels. We know this because when the final content dropped, there was a glitch on Scarif where you could see the reflection of Capital ships through your gun's scope on the map. Okay, so we know absolutely nothing about these games. Outside of brief descriptions of three of them, they would have all been third-person shooters, and their titles. LucasArts at one point intended to create a franchise called Star Wars Rebel, and would have had games like Rebel Agent, Rebel Fury, Rebel Jedi, Rebel Warrior, and Rebel Scum. The only descriptions we have are for Rebel Agent, where it's just about a Rebel agent trying to defeat the Empire, Rebel Jedi, where it's the same thing, but now it's a Jedi trying to stop the Empire, and Rebel Warrior, which is about an enslaved Wookiee and Kashyyyk fighting to get the Empire off his planet. Alright, we're finally here. We've finally made it to the deleted scene section. First up, the prequel trilogy. And oh boy, is there a ton of them to go over. These aren't going to be all of them, but they're going to be most of them. First, in Phantom Menace, we have Qui-Gon, Obi-Wan, and Jar Jar escaping their Bongo sub before it goes over a waterfall. Anakin fighting Greedo. Yes, that Greedo. Qui-Gon and Maul's duel in Tatooine is longer, and has Maul briefly board Padme's ship. R2-D2 falls off a platform at Coruscant before flying back up with his rocket boosters. Yaddle actually talks. And there's a scene where Anakin says goodbye to some woman that we didn't see earlier in the film. In Attack of the Clones, Padme introduces her family to Anakin on Naboo and shows him her room. Dooku, Jango, and Paco the Lesser interrogate Anakin and Padme before putting them on trial. Obi-Wan and Jocasta Nu discuss the Lost 20, the Lost 20 being 20 Jedi Masters who have left the Order. During the Battle of Geonosis, Ki-Adi-Mundi, Plo Koon, and some other Jedi would raid a droid control ship. This would be an entire subplot during the battle, and would have had them destroy the ship, resulting in a bunch of battle droids shutting down before reactivating, revealing to the audience that the droids now run on independent systems. Jango Fett briefly blocks Mace Windu's lightsaber with his armor. Mace Windu and Obi-Wan discuss stuff on a Jedi landing platform. Tank droids, which wouldn't make their film appearance until Revenge of the Sith, would actually be in Attack of the Clones, and be shown running over clone troopers. Anakin gives C-3PO his armored plating we see in the film. And finally, Obi-Wan goes to the Jedi Temple Analysis Room to study the poison dart. And finally, we have Revenge of the Sith, where Grievous kills Shaak-Ti on board the Invisible Hand, and Obi-Wan and Anakin would have to then escape in the ship's engines while being attacked by grapple droids. Three scenes, which involved Padme, Mon Mothma, Bail Organa, and several other senators meeting together, planting the seeds of the Rebel Alliance. Yoda arrives on Dagobah in exile. Obi-Wan chooses a creature to ride, ultimately choosing Bugga. Anakin killing Walt Tambar. Anakin also killing Shaak-Ti. Poor Shaak-Ti, she has like 10 different death scenes. Even more Order 66 deaths like Barriss Offee, Luminara, Sindarin, Quinlan Vos. Yoda talks to Qui-Gon Jinn's spirit. When Obi-Wan and Yoda arrive on Coruscant to investigate, they're attacked by clone troopers disguised as Jedi. This was cut so late into development, it was actually included in the LEGO game. A scene in which Padme confronts Anakin on Mustafar with a knife, intending to kill him. And finally, a scene in which Yoda, Tarful, and Chewbacca escapes from clones after Order 66 by playing dead. For A New Hope, there's a bunch of deleted scenes. For example, Luke Skywalker at Toshi Station, where he meets up with his old friends Biggs, Kami, and Fixer. This would lead to a scene where Luke and Biggs talk about leaving Tatooine, and Biggs revealing he's joining the Rebel Alliance, not the Empire. Luke Skywalker and C-3PO riding in a land speeder, which looks absolutely terrible. Luke watches the Empire's attack on the Tantive IV from Tatooine. When we first meet Han Solo in the cantina, he's hanging out and kissing a woman named Jenny. Luke's land speeder races into the town of Anchorhead and nearly runs over an old woman. I don't know where in the film this is going to be. Han Solo is confronted by Jabba the Hutt, who is originally human. This scene would actually be re-edited to the film in the special edition, with Jabba now CGI and Boba Fett added into the background, which makes this scene canon. A scene where Darth Vader tells Chief Bass to widen the search for the missing droids. Fun fact, this scene was actually reused in the Star Wars Holiday Special, but redubbed. Luke, Obi-Wan, C-3PO, and R2 stay at the town of Bestine for the night on their trip to Mos Eisley. Pondo Baba is going to be decapitated instead of having his arm cut off. Then, in Empire Strikes Back, we have scenes like, during the attack on Echo Base, a bunch of Wampas would attack. During this, C-3PO would trick some snowtroopers into opening a door with a Wampa behind it. Luke would then also battle a few Wampas with a heavy cannon. Luke and Leia make out some more. Nope. Guys, don't do that. I don't know what the laws of incest are in Star Wars, but, you know, I'm pretty positive it's not encouraged. 2-1-B, a medical droid, looks over a dead Tauntaun. You'd actually see remnants of the scene in the film when Han asks where Luke has gone. Lobot gets captured by stormtroopers and executed. Jesus Christ, okay. Luke returns to Echo Base and witnesses the carnage left behind. And finally, in Return of the Jedi, we have Moff Gerjerod struggles to shoot the Death Star's planet-destroying laser at Endor, because he doesn't want to kill his own men. This would have been added in the films to humanize some of the stormtroopers that work on the station. Luke, Han, Leia, Lando, Chewbacca, and the droids get back to the Falcon during a sandstorm after escaping Jabba the Hutt. Luke finishes building his new lightsaber and gives it to R2-D2. General Krix Mandine is shown on board the Home One. This was actually done just in case Ackbar's puppet effects didn't work properly and they had to replace him. Luke uses the Force to jump to the ceiling grate after falling into the Rancor pit, but is forced down by Jawas smashing their rifles against the sands. And finally, a scene where Leia grabs a vibro-staff and attacks a skiff-guard before going to the cannon and positioning it at the deck of Jawas' sail barge. In The Force Awakens, Unkar Plutt confronts Rey on Tekodana and starts to threaten her. In response, Chewbacca rips his fucking arms off. Leia warns her contact in the New Republic about the First Order. This contact is actually the same one we see in Hosnian Prime right before it gets destroyed. Finn and Rey steal a speeder on the Starkiller base and are chased down by another speeder. This scene would actually be canonized because a Force of the Destiny short adapts it. A scene in which Robert Bolter plays a younger Luke Skywalker was cut. During Rey's vision, she'd witness Luke and Vader dueling on Bespin from Empire Strikes Back. Kylo Ren and some snowtroopers search the Falcon on Starkiller base, causing him to sense Han Solo is there. And finally, a scene in which Finn, Han Solo, Chewbacca, and Maz are confronted by a group of stormtroopers on Takodana, who attempt to arrest them in the name of Supreme Leader Snoke, to which Han asks, what makes him supreme? Then, in The Last Jedi, we have a scene where Rey's third lesson is shown, in which she spots a raiding ship attempting to attack some villagers. Luke warns her that if she retaliates, the raiders will just come again with greater forces. She ignores him, and when she shows up, it's revealed that it wasn't actually a raiding party at all. It was just a celebration. Finn gets spanked by a stormtrooper in the elevator. He does this because he's happy for him. He doesn't know he's deserted, so he's just, you know, he's happy for his friend. Alright. Also, the Stormtrooper is played by Tom Hardy for some reason. Rose flat out bites Hux's hand when he starts to taunt her after capturing her. An alternate ending to Phasma's story in which Finn reveals to a bunch of Stormtroopers that she was the one that turned off Starkiller Base's shields, basically betraying the First Order. The Stormtroopers then aim at her, to which Phasma quickly guns them down. She knocks Finn down and tells him that he was always scum, to which he responds, Rebel scum, and shoots her with one of the dead stormtroopers' weapons. After escaping the Supremacy, Finn and Rose travel to Crait, to which Finn tells her that they're going where they belong. And finally, a scene with which Luke mourns over Han Solo's death. Alright, I loved The Last Jedi, but seriously, why the fuck wasn't this scene in the film? It's only like 50 seconds long. Why would... Come on, guys, really? And then finally, in The Rise of Skywalker, we have a scene in which the Eye of Webbish Baw confronts Kylo Ren on Mustafar and tells him that if he proceeds down this path, he'll encounter his true self. This scene actually was made canon with the film's novelization. And finally, Kylo Ren interrogates Chewbacca and sees visions of him as a child with Chewbacca. And that's it. Yeah, it's weird. They just, like, decided to not really reveal many deleted scenes for Rise of Skywalker, for whatever reason. So when Rex, Wolf, and Gregor showed up in the second season of Star Wars Rebels, many fans speculated that more clones would show up, like Cody. Some fans even speculated that Cody would return as a villain, where he'd work with the Empire just like how in Legends he stayed with the Empire and trained stormtroopers on Kamino. Ultimately, Cody would never show up in the show, despite being mentioned a couple times. But funny enough, Cody was actually intended to show up in Rebels as an antagonist, like many speculated. Writers for the show came up with an idea that had Thrawn realizing the Rebels were working with clones, which would lead him to bring in Cody to assist tracking them down. Here's How is a canceled Star Wars-themed educational show. It would have featured C-3PO teaching foreign language and R2-D2 explaining physical science. With his beeps? Or were they going to give him a... Were they going to give him a voice? It's completely unrelated, but another Star Wars educational series starring the iconic duo would later be released in 1999 in the form of two books titled Star Wars Science Adventures. So there's this misconception about Return of the Jedi. Most people know by now that the original name was Revenge of the Jedi. But that's not true. The original title was Return of the Jedi. You see, George Lucas wanted the title to be Return of the Jedi from the very beginning, but Lawrence Kasdan told him that Return was a weak title, so they changed it to Revenge of the Jedi. But then it was changed back to Return of the Jedi because George said that Jedi wouldn't seek revenge. Project Ragtag was a canceled Star Wars game being developed by Visceral Games that would have been an open-world action game that would have been a cross between Assassin's Creed 4 and the Tomb Raider reboot trilogy. While working on the project, EA forced many of Visceral Games members to work on Battlefield Hardline and its DLC, which left the game in a very difficult place, with very few people working on it. In 2014, Amy Hennig joined its project. She'd been heavily involved with the Uncharted series, and under her leadership, the project turned into a linear action game like the Uncharted games, and would have been a heist game. Work on the game continued pretty well, until Hardline's DLC forced members of Visceral to work on that instead. To make matters worse, EA executives didn't like how the game didn't have lightsabers with the Force in it. And then finally, in 2017, Ragtag was cancelled, and Visceral Games was shut down, after they showed EA executives gameplay of Ragtag involving an AT-ST chase, a Tatooine shootout, and a descent into Jabba's palace. But then the game was revived by EA Vancouver, but then cancelled again, permanently in early 2019. There's a lot more details on the project I left out because of time, so I'd recommend watching a video by gamers about multiple canceled Star Wars games, including Project Ragtag. Also, because EA shut down Visceral Games, the last piece of Dead Space content we'll ever get was a cameo in Battlefield Hardline. Life isn't fair. After the Boba Fett film was cancelled, another spinoff was put into production. This time, a film about the town from A New Hope, Mos Eisley. And that's about it. It was canceled in 2018, and nobody knows what the plot was going to be. Some speculated it would be an anthology film, some people speculated it was going to be about a bounty hunter, and some people even speculated that Jabba the Hutt was going to be a major presence in it. One thing's for certain, nobody knows anything about this project, besides it was going to take place on Tatooine. You know, the planet that's been 6 of the 9 saga films. Seriously, go to a new planet. During the 70s, George Lucas had an idea for 12 Star Wars saga films, and at least 2 spin-off films, one of which would star R2-D2 and C-3PO as the main protagonists after A New Hope was such a massive success. According to Lucas, there wasn't going to be any humans in the film, just droids. So think robots. But after The Empire Strikes Back, he never mentioned this film ever again, and any concepts for this movie were probably worked into the droids cartoon series, which for some reason is the only EU cartoon that's not on Disney Plus. Alright, well there you go. Side note, weird how we're getting a droids central project on Disney Plus now. Who knows, maybe some ideas from the scrapped film return. Probably not. Like I mentioned before, Lucas had a bunch of ideas for spin-off films, one of which would be about Wookiees, and would feature exclusively Wookiees. But after something called The Holiday Special happened, Lucas realized that making a film about a planet of Bigfoot screaming at each other with no subtitles wouldn't do too well. So it was cancelled. So D&D from Game of Thrones fame were hired to write and produce a Star Wars trilogy in 2019, with their first film being released in 2023. But then they were fired because of scheduled conflicts. It's been theorized and rumored that the trilogy would have been about the Old Republic, but this was never confirmed. Instead, it seems like it might have been about the origins of the Jedi, which is what Variety reported on. Now that Rogue Squadron is set for release in 2023, it seems that this trilogy was just ultimately scrapped altogether. Star Wars Detours is a lost Star Wars non-canon comedy series that would have been a parody of the franchise. It was created by George Lucas and had Seth Green and Todd Grimes heavily involved in production. However, once Disney bought Lucasfilm in 2014, the show was put on an indefinite hiatus. That was 7 years ago. There's been 39 episodes completed, and there doesn't seem to be any chance of its release, even though in 2018 Lucasfilm did file a new trademark for the series. In 2020, an episode was leaked onto Reddit, so maybe it's a Deadpool situation where they purposely leak something to gauge audience reactions.
Yo dudes, the Empire's pretty chill. Maybe you could like join it or something.
A third installment in the Ewok film series was planned in the 1980s, but it never actually made it out of early development. Sadly, we don't know anything about what the film's plot, besides the fact that it would have been about, you know, Ewoks. Star Wars Underworld was a live-action Star Wars series George Lucas was creating throughout the 2000s. The show would have taken place in between Revenge of the Sith and A New Hope, and would have hour-long episodes. Around 50 scripts were written for it, though Lucas planned for 100 episodes, but proposed 400. That's 400 hours of Star Wars. Well, what would the show be about? Everything. No, seriously. Everything. From characters like Leia, Han Solo, Chewbacca, Quillen Voss, Palpatine, Boba Fett, Typho, Watto, Sebulba, Lando, Greedo, Nanub, Galen Merrick, Jabba the Hutt, Ted Nub, Snoodles, etc. Fucking everyone was rumored or flat out planned to appear. The only three plotlines we know for a fact that were going to be in the show include Han Solo and Chewbacca's first meeting, Lando losing the Falcon to Han, and Palpatine's love life. Yes, Palpatine's love life. In the show, Palpatine was going to be portrayed as a sympathetic character, as he had apparently been wronged by some woman. Anyways, the show was teased at Celebration and talked about publicly several times. George even hired a ton of writers to work on it. So why wasn't it made? The budget. In order to make George's vision, the show would need an insane amount of money for each episode. So it was eventually canceled in 2010. However, Underworld had a pretty strong legacy for a canceled project. For example, the Church of the Force, a background element in The Force Awakens, was originally created for the show, along with Palpatine's first name, Sheev. Saul Guerrero was conceived for Underworld, as was 1313. And not Star Wars related, but Kratos' story arc in God of War PS4 was actually inspired by unproduced Underworld scripts. In 2020, test footage of the show would be leaked and showed a Rebel agent stealing plans for a Star Destroyer. It's unknown if any more test footage exists. So as many already know, when The Clone Wars was cancelled back in 2014, there were plenty of plans for future episodes. In fact, 2.5 seasons were planned out, but were never finished. Well, that is until 2020, when Ahsoka's Walkabout, The Bad Batch, and The Siege of Mandalore were adapted. And then in 2014, when the 4 unfinished episodes of the Crystal Crisis arc were released on Stars.com. Oh, and in 2014, when the Son of Dathomir comic series was released, that was just adapted from the cancelled Son of Dathomir story arc. And the Dark Disciple novel in 2015 that adapted the 8-part story arc. Okay, besides those, there's still a bunch that hasn't been adapted yet. These include a Bounty Hunter arc that would have had Boba Fett and Cad Bane teaming up in a Bounty Hunter gang. Cad Bane would then train Boba Fett because he wanted to know who was better in a fight, he or Jango. Cad Bane also would have probably died in this arc. A story arc that took place on Kashyyyk, in which the Bad Batch and Yoda travel to the planet to help out Chewbacca and the Wookiees fight off some Separatist-backed Trandoshan pirates. It also would have had references to the Star Wars Holiday Special. An arc about Rex and R2-D2, what a pairing, that would have had the pair stranded on one of Ryloth's moons. There, along with a reprogrammed Super Battle Droid, would have had to survive in the harsh wilderness. Ahsoka would have returned to the Jedi Order in between the Walkabout arc and the Siege of Mandalore, and traveled below the Jedi Temple to investigate a Sith Temple. There, Ahsoka would have had a brief encounter with Darth Sidious. Anakin and Padme traveled back to Mon Cala, and would have had to deal with a murder mystery, and the Mon Calan government not exactly liking Palpatine. An alien abduction arc in the style of the X-Files would have had a Yuuzhan Vong scout ship, I'll talk about them a little bit later, kidnap some clones to assess the strength of the Republic. A prequel arc that told the story of Plo Koon discovering a young Ahsoka Tano. Plo Koon had to protect Ahsoka from a bounty hunter who was trying to trick the village into giving her the child. And while not confirmed, there were rumblings of another Zilla Beast episode. But like I said, it was never confirmed. Smuggler was a cancelled Star Wars game that began development in 2004, before being cancelled in 2005. It would have been about a smuggler in an Imperial-controlled galaxy. Shocker. The player would get rewards like credits for buying low and selling high, though that came with a risk of the Imperials discovering you. It was reportedly going to allow users to smuggle and trade between Facebook, tablets, and consoles. There's been a bunch of canceled Star Wars comics over the years, so in the interest of time, let's quickly go over a bunch. The Rise of Skywalker comic adaptation was canceled because of COVID-19. The Dark Horse Invasion storyline was going to be about an alien invasion in the Star Wars universe. It was canceled because it was too similar to the New Jedi Order book series. The original drafts for Crimson Empire 3, originally meant to be released in 2002, but was pushed all the way back until 2011. Jedi Barazofi, the sixth installment in a series of one-shots focusing on various Jedi from the prequel era, was canceled, but the story that would be told in the comic would later be adapted into Star Wars Republic Show of Force. Shadow of Vader, an anthology series about Vader's influence in the galaxy, different eras, was canceled because the author Chuck Wendig got fired from Lucasfilm. Exiles of the Force was going to be a four-part miniseries in 1996 that would have had Luke and Leia battling a new Force-related threat. And finally, Spectre of Thrawn, in which would have been a tie-in comic to the Hand of Thrawn duology, which I'll talk about later. Star Wars Attack Squadrons was basically Star Wars Squadrons before Star Wars Squadrons. Attack Squadrons was a space combat game developed by Disney Interactive Worlds in Area 52 Games, made in the Unity engine. It had modifiable ships, and up to 16-player matches in three modes. In 2014, it had a 5-month beta testing before being cancelled. Originally, Rogue One was meant to be a lot darker. In 2016, rumors began that Disney ordered substantial reshoots in an effort to lighten the film's tone, though Entertainment Weekly confirmed the reshoots were most likely just to add character development, rather than actually change the film's plot. The most notable things changed were all the character deaths being moved to the final act, and the addition of the Vader scene. You know what I'm talking about. It can also be assumed that some of the footage shown in Rogue One's trailers that weren't in the film came from this original version. Though it's been confirmed most of that footage was made exclusively for the trailers, but still, you can speculate. Meanwhile, with Solo, directors Laura Miller departed from the project due to creative differences while filming. Apparently, they kept trying to change the story, and the duo refused to change their approach to the film. Because of this, Ron Howard would take over, and some changes began to happen. For example, Michael Kenneth Williams was originally going to play Dryden Voss, who would have been an alien. But because he couldn't come in for reshoots, Paul Bettany replaced him. So just like with the cancelled comics, there's been a whole bunch of cancelled novels too. So let's go over them one by one. First we have Blood Oath, a novel set to be released in 2009, was ultimately cancelled. It would have been about Jedi Knight Zek, who would team up with some other characters to stop some unknown conflict. Then we have The New Jedi Order Nightfall, a trilogy in the New Jedi Order series. It'd be about the Yuuzhan Vong attempting to wipe out all Jedi. The three books were titled Jedi Storm, Jedi Fire, and Jedi Blood. The Heart of the Jedi was meant to take place right after the events of Return of the Jedi, but was cancelled because the author, Kenneth C. Flint, couldn't make the novel fit into canon. It's a genuine shame this book was cancelled, because not only did it destroy Kenneth's relationship with Bantam Spectra, the editing company that worked with Lucasfilm at the time, but also destroyed his career as a writer, at least according to him. Escape from Dagoo took place between Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith, and it was about Shaak Ti going on a mission to the swamp planet of Dagoo and attempt to rescue slaves being used by the Confederacy. Guess why it was cancelled? Budget? No. Trouble in Lucasfilm? Nope. It's because Shaak Ti wasn't as marketable as, say, Yoda. That led to the creation of Yoda Dark Rendezvous instead, which, don't get me wrong, is a great book. But that's a really shitty reason to cancel a novel. Though the events of this canceled novel are still considered canon to Legends purely because the events of it are mentioned in other material. Probably the most famous canceled Star Wars novels, The Sword of the Jedi trilogy would have been the fourth and potentially final installment of the mainline Star Wars novel series in Legends. That began with the New Jedi Order and continued with Legacy of the Force, and then Fate of the Jedi. It would have been about Jaina Solo fighting Sith, I assume. This trilogy was cancelled simply because Disney rebooted the timeline. Imperial Commando 2 was going to be a sequel to the novel Imperial Commando 501st, making it the sixth installment in the Republic Commando novel series. A lot of this novel's plot details have actually been revealed, so, here you go, for those who read the books. Alien Exodus was the title of the first installment in a canceled trilogy of novels in 2003. This story was probably the most unusual Star Wars series to date. It would have been split up into two parts, the first being a history of humans in the Star Wars universe, and would show them as slaves on a far-off planet. It would also touch upon the origin of the name Skywalker, the Force, and the huts of all creatures. Then the second half would be told in excerpts from a document called The Human Exodus, that traces the origins of humanity to a long-lost expedition from 25th century Earth. Yes, making Earth canon to Star Wars. But that's not all. It would also contain references to American Graffiti and THX 1138, making them canon too. Legacy of Doom was a novel that would have been a sequel to the canceled novel Heart of the Jedi, but was canceled because of differencing of opinions. In 2016, the author Joseph Bongerino attempted to publish the novel on his website. He stated that it was canceled because every time he handed the novel to Lucasfilm, they kept changing their minds about what they wanted, so eventually he gave up. And finally, the most recent cancellation, The Mandalorian Original Novel, which obviously wasn't the final title, was a book planned for release in 2021 that dealt with The Mandalorian, but was canceled for unknown reasons. Though with its cancellation, they did announce another Mandalorian novel replacing it. The final project George Lucas was ever involved with prior to the Disney buyout was a spin-off series to The Clone Wars focusing on younglings, but was ultimately scrapped. The plot details would later be worked into the Younglings arc in Season 5. So a lot of people think Palpatine's return in The Rise of Skywalker was out of nowhere, but what they don't know is that Palpatine's return was always planned from the very beginning. J.J. Abrams even wanted him to be in The Force Awakens, but ultimately decided against it. Details of this can be found in The Force Awakens art book. Very minor remnants of this can actually be seen in The Force Awakens novelization, in which Rey hears Palpatine's voice briefly when she touches the Skywalker saber. In 2019, EA shut down production of a spin-off to Battlefront 2. Codenamed Viking, this game was expected to release in 2020, but they couldn't finish it within the time they wanted, so it was cancelled. The game would have been made by EA Vancouver and featured open-world elements. Criterion also would have helped out.
Hey, look what I found.
Right now, get one of these cool Star Wars collector cups, each featuring one of your favorite characters, exclusively at Taco Bell, KFC, and Pizza Hut.
All right, just real quick before we talk about the EU stuff. I'm in no way saying that these are bad stories in any way. I'm just saying this because I know some people might be like, what are you insulting my story? Like, no, I'm not at all. I'm just saying they're weird in the grand scheme of things. But weird's good. Most of the time. I'll state when I dislike something, but I will make sure, I mean, it's my opinion. It just, I mean, you know, everything's subjective. So I'll say it's my opinion, but hey, you like it? That's totally great. I got no issue with that. All right. So, yeah. So remember when I talked about Battlefront 3 and how Elite Squadron was just that game for the PSP? Well, because Elite Squadron exists, we can experience Battlefront 3's story. And oh boy, it's something. You play as X2, one of two Force-sensitive clone troopers who fight without a helmet for whatever reason. They weren't created for Jango Fett, but instead Fallon Grey, some random Jedi who was the apprentice of Rom Koda. Yes, that Koda from Force Unleashed. Fun fact, this is actually Koda's final appearance chronologically in Legends. Anyways, his brother X1 becomes a Sith Lord and battles against X2, who becomes a Jedi. During the battles against each other, X2 attacks the Death Star with some other X-Wings, because in Legends there were like 10 different attacks on the Death Star. And the two even have a duel on Mustafar, set a couple years after the original trilogy, in which X2 tricks X1 into killing himself. Yeah, this was a game. Okay, look, I love the Thrawn trilogy as much as the next guy, but I'm really not a fan of this aspect of it. Anyways, Luke Skywalker was a clone of Luke created by Joris Koboth by using Luke's severed hand from The Empire Strikes Back, and even used the Skywalker saber. This was done because Joris wanted to have at least one Skywalker on his side when both Luke and Mara Jade turned him down. So Luke and Luke fought, and ultimately Mara Jade stepped in and killed the clone. Although decades later, in 2012, Lucasfilm released a non-canon April Fool's story called An Apology that explained that Mara Jade had accidentally killed the real Luke and the clone simply took his place. Ultimately, another clone of Luke was made, named Luke, with three U's, who would then use a time machine to go back in time to the Clone Wars. There were also like 10 other clones that were just the same names but with added letters. It's a wild story. So many people don't actually know this, but in both Legends and canon, IG-88 isn't actually IG-88. It's IG-88B. You see, there are four different models of the same droid. Though IG-88A, B, and D are really the only three that actually got any story content. Anyways, in Legends, IG-88A was working on a galaxy-wide droid revolution and had B work for him. And one of his greatest accomplishments was taking control of the second Death Star. Yep, in Return of the Jedi, it was actually retconned so that IG-88A was actually the one firing the Death Star laser. Well, kinda. He helped aim it. Anyways, when the second Death Star, aka his second body, was destroyed, he returned to his original body. Weird, right? Well, this actually also happens in canon, but this time, IG-88B was the one that did it, as A hasn't really done anything in canon outside of just existing, barely. And the funny thing is, it's only canon because the story was briefly mentioned in a mobile game, but the difference here is that R2-Q5 was able to stop him from taking complete control over the Death Star. So everyone talks about when Palpatine came back to life. Four separate times, and how Darth Maul was retconned into surviving alongside Boba Fett. But nobody ever wants to talk about the time General Grievous came back from the dead. In the now-defunct MMO Star Wars Galaxies, there was a mission in which you had to battle a battle droid named NK Necrosis. Necrosis was created by Dr. Kingsworthy, who was hired by the Empire to revive General Grievous by using an advanced droid brain in the body of Grievous. While it didn't have Grievous' memories, it still had his skill for the most part. Instead of using multiple lightsabers, he was just armed with one double-bladed red lightsaber, and General Grievous' personal blaster, the Grievance Striker. He also worked alongside two aging Magna Guards dubbed NK3. Outside of this MMO, Necrosis was mentioned in a couple of lore stuff, but never appeared again since, I mean, you kill him in the game. In the comic The Return of Ben Kenobi, Darth Vader hires an actor to pretend to be Obi-Wan Kenobi using plastic surgery in order to trick Luke Skywalker into a trap. However, during his mission to trick Luke into a trap, he comes to like him in the Rebels, so he quits the job. Though he did this right in front of Vader, so Vader kinda, you know, killed him. Mortally wounded, the actor caused a power overload that destroyed most of the building the two were in, almost killing Vader. We never actually learned his name, and in The Rise and Fall of Darth Vader, released many decades later, the events of this comic were actually referenced, including the actor himself, making it one of the very few Marvel comics to be remembered and acknowledged by modern Legends writers. Okay, so this may or may not be canon to Legends, but elements of it are, so I'm going to assume at least some aspects of it are. In the comic Phantom Menaces, featured in Star Wars Tales, years after Return of the Jedi, Luke Skywalker meets a man named Jarel Kumph, who managed to retrieve Darth Maul's brain and spinal cord somehow, and place them into a specialized battery tank wired up to a device that creates a physical hologram of Maul, who can then kill people. Luke ends up stopping him and turns off the machine, finally killing Maul. While the events of this aren't totally known to be canon to Legends, Kumph and his ownership of a brain that supposedly belongs to Maul are canon. In yet another case of Maul coming back from the dead, in Legends, the comic Resurrection, also featured in Star Wars Tales, has Maul being resurrected by a group known as the Prophets of the Dark Side because they figure Vader isn't worthy enough to be Palpatine's apprentice. So Maul and Vader duel, and Maul gets the upper hand, which leads to Vader then stabbing himself through the chest to kill Maul. This comic is 100% canon to Legends, and was even supposed to be a comic miniseries before being scrapped and turned into a short story. While written off as just some non-canon pre-order skin for Force Unleashed 2 by many people, Maulkiller is actually canon to Legends and received his own backstory. In an attempt at cloning Galen Merrick, Vader decided to just combine Galen and Maul's DNA, resulting in Maulkiller. Why he thought this was a good idea? I don't have any fucking idea. I mean, this is the same Vader that hired an actor to play Obi-Wan, so you know, he's not really thinking straight all the time. This being was extremely unstable and had serious anger and mental problems, and struck fear into everyone he faced, including Vader himself. In the second and third installments of the Carillion trilogy, written in the mid-90s, the OG cast of characters comes face to face with Hunchuzuk Den, a group of sentient giant otters that were called Solanians. They were specifically bred to negotiate with aliens. One such member was named Drachmus, who joined forces with Han Solo and the crew against Han Solo's cousin, Thrakken Sal Solo. Though upon first meeting Han Solo, the two engaged in a brutal fight. Solanians would go on to appear in a bunch of other Star Wars media, though they were retconned into looking more humanoid versus their original appearance, where they were quite literally just big otters.
Alan.
So there's a species in Legends called the Tishar, who are literally just sentient velociraptors. In fact, they even belong to the theropod group. They first appeared in Han Solo at Star's End in 1979, and were only featured in two other stories afterwards, though they received extensive coverage in multiple Star Wars lore books. Apparently they were known for being master businessmen and cunning assassins. The lifespan is roughly 65 years. Oh, I get it, haha. And they're also kinda canon. They're briefly mentioned in the lore book Star Wars Smuggler's Guide, although we know, quite literally, nothing about them. So remember when Empire Strikes Back, when Luke gets attacked by that Wampa and only narrowly escapes getting eaten by it after cutting off its arm? Well, what if they met up again? In the novel Darksaber, no, not that Darksaber, it's a reference to this Darksaber, which we'll talk about later, which takes place 9 years after Empire Strikes Back, Luke returns to Hoth and comes into contact with this Wampa again, now known as One Arm. One Arm has since become a leader of a gang of Wampas and attempts to kill Luke again, but this time Luke actually manages to kill her. The Dark Empire trilogy was a comic series that began in 1991 and ended in 1995. It's about Palpatine coming back to life using clone bodies, leading a new Imperial army called the Dark Empire, using massive World Devastator superweapons, and the Eclipse, the most powerful Star Destroyer in history. Luke Skywalker also very briefly joins Palpatine in the Sith Order. After Palpatine gets eventually killed in the first installment by, well, himself, his spirit went into another clone body and tried to possess the infant Anakin Solo, but was literally shot in the back by Han Solo. With this final clone body dead, his spirit got back up and tried one last attempt to possess him, but a Jedi named... I'm not pronouncing that. Showed up, grabbed Palpatine's spirit, and brought it with him to the afterlife, finally killing Palpatine. Side note, it's hinted that in this, Palpatine's death in Return of the Jedi wasn't his first death. George Lucas himself was actually involved with this trilogy to an extent, as he said he liked the idea of Palpatine returning through cloning, and shot down ideas that it was actually an imposter. He also apparently loved the comic. Now you're probably curious, did Lucasfilm partially adapt elements of Dark Empire for the sequel trilogy? Yeah. Kariz was one of Vader's many apprentices in Legends. She's notable for being a Skytree, basically a gargoyle-like species. She first appeared in Star Wars Annual 1 in 1979 and battled Luke Skywalker and his friends using an anti-gravity belt and throwing stars. She was an evil dictator that hoped that someday someone would come to her world and kill her in order to free her people. So I guess she was pretty hyped when Luke killed her. Strangely enough, she actually returned in the 2011 prequel novella Skywalker's A Clone Wars Story, which told the story about how she first met Vader as Anakin Skywalker and helped he and Obi-Wan defeat a separatist threat. Interestingly enough, this prequel story was set up in the original comic all those years ago. So like, in canon we have the Inquisitors, but did you know that in Legends, not only were there also Inquisitors working for the Empire, but the Empire made several attempts at mass-producing Sith soldiers. And before anyone goes, are you talking about the Reborn Sith from Jedi Outcast and Jedi Academy? No, that's the Imperial Remnant. I'm talking about the actual Empire. First, we have the Saber Guard, appearing in The Force Unleashed 2, who often worked alongside the Imperial Sith Acolytes. Then there's the Kuus clones. Six clone stormtroopers cloned from the Sith assassin Sakuus. They were an attempt at creating a cloned Sith army, but all of them would eventually betray the Empire and, well, were killed almost immediately. Then there's also the Shadow Guards in Force Unleashed, who were elite soldiers that were personally trained by Vader himself. There's also the Imperial Royal Guards, who weren't Force-sensitive. Most of the time. They randomly were in The Force Unleashed. Oh, and the Imperial Senate Guard, who were also Force-sensitive. You'd think with all these Sith soldiers, the Empire would have been able to defeat the Rebels. But no. All of them were either dead or fired by the time of A New Hope. The Jedi Prince series is one of the rare, universally hated Star Wars stories. Basically, the story was about Ken, a 12-year-old Force-sensitive kid who was the grandson of Palpatine, traveling around the galaxy that involved Triclops, who I will get to later because trust me, he deserved his own spot in this video, Mount Yoda, a literal fantasy dwarf named Supreme Prophet of the Dark Side Cadian, and of course, this story also includes the iconic line, I bid you dark greetings. Since their release in 1992 and 1983, Lucasfilm has attempted to retcon them several times. In an unlicensed magazine, it was stated that the series had actually just been a children's story that Leia had told her children. But in the Darkseid sourcebook, they retconned the story to be true, but with a ton of continuity fixes. And literally 1 year after the final book of the series was released, the novel The Courtship of Princess Leia tells the story of Leia and Han getting married, despite the final book of the Jedi Princess series having them get married. The Crystal Star is one of the strangest Star Wars novels out there. Released in 1994, it tells the story of Han and Leia's kids being kidnapped, which was a common thing in Legends. Really, really, really common. Luke and Han would then get split up from Leia, and the two groups have their own wacky and weird adventures. How weird? Well, there's Waru, who, like Triclops, I'll talk about later because he deserves his own spot on here. Luke then joins an evil cult briefly. The story also introduces werewolves and centaurs in the Star Wars universe. Or, I'm sorry, the Quadrigi, who are a race of four-armed humanoids who are born as six-legged canines that encase themselves into a cocoon at puberty, who would then later emerge as humanoids 2 weeks later. And the Kyrian, who... No, they're just centaurs. That's kind of it. Oh, and then there's the Ghostlings, which is a species that is extremely sexually attracted to humans. That aspect of them wouldn't really come back anytime this species reappeared in Legends. I love me some Star Wars walkers. AT-ATs, AT-STs, AT-TEs, AT-M6s, UATTs, etc. You name them, I love them. I even love the OICT, and that one crane from The Mandalorian. But there's one walker that I'm not super big on, and that's the MT-AT, aka the Mountain Terrain Armored Transport. I remember seeing a picture of one years ago and not thinking it was actually an official thing. Here we are. Seen only in the novel Champions of the Force, these massive walkers were designed to scale mountains. They were later retconned to be based on the crab droids used by the Separatists. No, not the spider droids. The crab droids. Overall, I just think it's really funny that the Empire was just kind of like, I'll just make like a giant spider walker thing, you know? Why not? Beldorian was a Jedi Knight who fell to the dark side and was later killed by Leia in a lightsaber duel. Sounds like your standard Dark Jedi, right? Well, he's a Hutt. Yeah, Beldorian was a fat, lazy old Hutt, in his own words, and used the Force to maintain a muscular form. Dude was so tough that when he swung his lightsaber, even if he blocked the blade, the force of the blow would probably break your wrists. Sadly for Beldorian, his self-claimed rulership over the planet of Namchoris was ended by Leia. Leia really is a Hutt slayer, goddamn. His only appearance was in the 1997 novel Planet of Twilight. Evan Nova, if you somehow ever see this video, could you please make a versus video about Beldorian fighting Colvin Treymor? Don't do it like a joke video, like make it as serious as you can. I would love to see the breakdown of his skill set. Am I putting this guy on here because I'm still bitter over getting my ass handed to me over and over again in Revenge of the Sith, the video game? No. But I'd be lying if I said it didn't influence me. The Clone Blaze Trooper was this weird juggernaut-like clone trooper that exclusively used flamethrowers. They could also grab enemies and crush them with their strength. I literally don't know if it's meant to be like a mech suit kind of thing, or there's pumping iron clone troopers in those suits.
I'm like getting the feeling of coming in the gym, I'm getting the feeling of coming at home, I'm getting the feeling of coming backstage when I pump up, when I pose out in front of 5,000 people, I get the same feeling, so I'm coming day and night. I mean, it's terrific, right? So, you know, I'm in heaven.
Like, what's the purpose of these guys? It's like, I mean, I assume to kill battle droids, but it's like... Dude, just use a gun. What flames do to a droid? Just use a gun, dude. Before anyone says, well, they might not be canon because they only appear in the Revenge of the video game. Great game, by the way. Well, they were name-dropped Republic Commando True Colors, so... Nope, they're canon to Legends. Star Wars Issue 81, Jawas of Doom, released in 1983, was the issue in which Boba Fett escaped the Sarlacc Pit. When he awakens from being spit out by the Great Pit of Carcoon, he loses his memory, and is brought on board a Sandcrawler because the Jawas on board think he's a droid. Through some shenanigans, Han Solo ends up with the Sandcrawler and meets up with Boba Fett, who doesn't remember Han. He then helps out Han Solo rescue R2-D2, but then regains his memories and starts to attack Han. But Han dodges the attack and escapes the Sandcrawler. Shortly afterwards, that very same Sandcrawler falls into the Sarlacc, with Boba Fett still inside. don't worry, Boba Fett would escape the Sarlacc yet again in a short story, A Barb Like That, The Tale of Boba Fett, released in 1996. So some people complain that canon has too many super weapons, like two Death Stars, Starkiller Base, that fleet at the end of Rise of Skywalker, and the Malachor Sith Temple. Which, I mean, fair enough, I agree that they should stop using super weapons as much, especially Planet Busters. But this isn't something Star Wars is just now doing. Let's quickly go over most of them. The Darksaber was a super weapon built by the Hutts that could destroy planets and made its first appearance in Darksaber. The Starforge was a super weapon that could create an endless amount of ships, droids, and other war materials, and first appeared in Knights of the Republic. The Tarkin was a giant super weapon that could also destroy planets and made its first appearance in Star Wars Issue 51, Resurrection of Evil. Centerpoint Station was a super weapon capable of moving entire planets and first appeared in Ambush at Corellia. The Death Star prototype was exactly what it sounds like, yet it could only destroy the cores of planets, rendering them uninhabitable, though it could destroy small moons. It first appeared in Jedi Search. Suncrusher was a starfighter-sized super weapon that could destroy entire solar systems by causing the center star to turn into a supernova. It also first appeared in Jedi Search. The Dark Reaper was a super weapon that looks almost exactly like a UFO. It harvested the life of anyone near it and used that energy as a massive beam that dealt massive damage. It first appeared in the Clone Wars game. Very underrated game. Maybe, I haven't played it since like 2007. The Shalkan device is a super weapon that would cause a domino effect by causing planets to crash into each other, destroying the entire universe. It first appeared in Star Wars Issue 87, still active after all these years. The Trigon 1 was a super weapon that could destroy entire planets. It first appeared in the cartoon Star Wars Droids. The Infinite Shaw was an artifact that could release force energy. It created a disturbance in the force so powerful it would destroy planets. It first appeared in Star Wars Jango Fett. The Galaxy Gun was an Imperial weapon that could destroy a planet. Its first appearance was in Dark Empire 2. The Conqueror was a Star Destroyer with a built-in super laser that could destroy small moons. Its only appearance was in the Star Wars Galaxy trading card game. The Orbital Night Cloak was a network of hundreds of satellites that could prevent all sunlight from hitting the planet, eventually turning the planet into solid ice, killing all life. It first appeared in the courtship of Princess Leia. And finally, the World Devastators, in which they used giant tractor beams to tear apart planets for resources. They first appeared in Dark Empire. Alright, so now we're on Triclops. Triclops was the son of Palpatine, though nobody knows if he was created biologically or by Darth Plagueis fucking around with midichlorians. Despite being the son of Palpatine, Palpatine deemed him to be a failure and threw him in prison, and somehow, in that prison, he had a kid named Ken. Now why is his name Triclops? Well, Tri refers to three, and well, Triclops has three eyes. His third one is on the back of his head. Yep, say what you want about the clone kinda son from Rise of Skywalker, at least he had two eyes. Well, who was his mother? Well, Slime Moore, of course. Side note, Slime Moore is one of the most terrifying characters in all of fiction. Jesus Christ, those fucking eyes. Since then, Star Wars writers have tried to retcon Triclops being Palpatine's son, but in 2013, Lucasfilm explicitly referred to Triclops as Palpatine's true son. And well, he's something. Oh yeah, and there's also Triculus, who pretended to be Triclops. Because of all people you want to pretend to be, you choose the dude with the eye in the back of the head. The man I will not pronounce was a Jedi Knight who survived Order 66, but he didn't last long as Vader hunted him down and destroyed his ship, causing him to be mortally injured. In order to save him, the people on the planet he crashed on gave him a prosthetic body, and he became their king. So what does this prosthetic body look like? Oh. Oh, that's hell. That's actual hell. He looks like a Weeble Wobble, but this dude is sure to fall down. Or not, because he has thrusters built into his suit so he can fly. This guy looks like he's in constant agonizing pain. Holy shit, imagine living your life like this. Decades later, once Palpatine came back from the grave, Brand came into contact with Luke and his friends, and so Brand joined his new Jedi Order before dying in the final installment in Dark Empire, stopping Palpatine, finally putting this man's suffering at an end. But wait, in Star Wars Union, you can see a dude that looks exactly like him in the background. But can't be him, because he's dead. What psychopath made another one of these dudes? Oh yeah, and did I mention his master was Yaddle? So Geode is a new character introduced in the High Republic era, as the navigator of a transport ship. But the thing is, he's a rock. Or at least he looks like a rock. He's part of the Vitian species, which are literally just sentient rocks. He's a pretty funny character that people really take issue with. Seriously, the amount of people going,
Wow, Star Wars ran out of ideas. Look at the SJW Wars pulling out now. No wonder the High Republic is failing. Oh, it's actually, it's not failing at all, actually. It's actually... Like, you guys realize he's a joke, right? Like, you're supposed to find him funny. There's literally a scene in the novel Into the Dark where one of the characters spots Geode in the mess hall and are like, How did he move? How did he get here? Like, it's very clear you guys just didn't read the books. You just saw a picture of it and were like, ugh. What the fuck? Goddamn, we're gonna have some fucking fun. Side note, he's also terrifying and disgusting when you stop and think about him for a few minutes. I mean, this dude is a living thing, right? So he's got blood and guts. So he's basically a giant meat rock. That's fucking disgusting. Nobody ever really talks about the sequel to the Thrawn trilogy, the Hand of Thrawn duology, which contains the two books Spectre of the Past and Vision of the Future. And it's probably not talked about as much because people tend not to like the whole cloning thing when reviving dead characters, at least from what I've seen. I know I'm iffy on the whole thing myself. But in the second book, Luke and Mara Jade discovered that Thrawn had created a clone of himself as a failsafe in case he died. And there it sat in a packed tank for over a decade underneath some facility. They decided against killing the clone because they felt it would be immoral, but were forced to in order to escape after some droids caused the room to flood with water. Okay, so I'm just clarifying again, because people don't get mad. I'm not saying these stories are bad. I'm just saying they're kind of weird in the grand scheme of things. Okay? Alright. Anyways, Star Wars Legacy was a comic series that took place over 100 years after the original trilogy. It was about Cade Skywalker and his friends, and R2-D2, who's still kicking somehow, battling Darth Krayt, who I absolutely love as a character and villain, and his new Sith Empire. Since its creation in 2006, it's become one of the most well-received eras in Star Wars. Though it's weird that Krayt uses stormtroopers and nobody complains about that, but when the First Order does it, it's lazy writing. I don't know, just, you know, things to think about. Anyways, Krayt is a century-old Sith who started out as a Tusken Raider Jedi who was featured in the Republic comic series. Kept alive for a century through torture, he became the Dark Lord of the Sith we know and love. Then there's Cade Skywalker, who's kind of like that weird trend in the mid-2000s, where you get like the cooler, edgier version of a established character. But luckily, he managed to stand out on his own and be a solid character. Then you got Darth Talon, who is a pretty good character in her own right, and wears pretty much nothing. And like I said, R2-D2 is still kicking around, as are Stormtroopers. And you also got weird TIE variants like the TIE Predator and a bunch of other stuff. I'd recommend reading it. So in the 1998 novel Galaxy of Fear, Clones, Vader battled a clone of himself that was grown in a Dantooine cloning facility. He was created by cloning droids who took some of Vader's blood and imprinted the clone with Vader's personality from the mental imprints left in his blood? The clone didn't need the suit, but he still wore it, probably because it looks awesome. And he had a fake lightsaber that couldn't actually cut through anything and couldn't hurt anyone. And when Vader met up with it, he didn't really take too kindly to it and had a brief little duel with him and killed him. Because, I mean, you take a real lightsaber, you pit it against a fake one, you know what's going to happen. Only appearing in the 2D Clone Wars microseries, the Clone Lantern Trooper was a clone that was literally just created to lance. Imagine being a clone trooper. You're raised into the slavery military with cool armor, cool blasters and all that stuff, and you see all the clones training, your brother's training. You're like, dude, I can't wait to battle with my brothers, this is gonna be sick, we're gonna kick ass. But then some giraffe person comes up to you and is like, oh no, you're gonna spend the rest of your life driving speeder bikes with no blasters mounted on them into battle. You'll be using lances to stab droids though. Avaloth is an interesting character. She's the mother on Mortis, and unlike the father, son, and daughter who appear in the Clone Wars Rebels, she didn't make the jump into canon. Probably because her power level is insane. She's technically the most powerful character in all of Star Wars and can't die. Because of how powerful and twistedly evil she became after she drank from the font of power and bathed in the pool of knowledge, the father left her behind, stranded in an unknown jungle world. However, anytime the forces altered, the flow of time changed, Avaloth would escape, to result in the son and daughter teaming up to kill her and bring her back to a prison world. But then Anakin, Obi-Wan, and Ahsoka were kind of them responsible for the father, son, and daughter dying. So when Avaloth woke up again, there wasn't anyone to stop her. She became a monstrous spirit that took the form of many, including the chief of state in the Galactic Alliance. The Jedi and Sith then had to team up in order to defeat her in the realm of Beyond Shadows, which is a realm in the Force in which people separate their minds from their physical bodies. Anyways, even after Luke was able to kill her, he knew that she'd return eventually, and so decided to find Mortis to locate the dagger of Mortis, the only weapon that can permanently kill Mortis God, so he could end her threat once and for all. But then the reboot happened, so I don't know, I guess he did it at some point in that continuity. So zombies have shown up several times in Star Wars, most notably in the novel Death Troopers in 2009, and its prequel Red Harvest in 2010. Variations of zombies have also appeared in Riptide in 2011, Galaxy of Fear, City of the Dead 1997, No Way Out in 2007, and Dawn of the Jedi, which I'll talk about a little later. However, the most notable appearance was in the Clone Wars, which they appear in both the Second Battle of Geonosis arc in Season 2, and on Dathomir when the Separatists attack the Night Sisters in Season 4. These zombies even went on to appear in Jedi Fallen Order. So in both Legends and canon, there's been some living mountains. First in Legends, there's Mount Sorrow, which was a mountain that cried tears of healing and was in a constant state of depression. And hold on, can we just discuss his amazing Wikipedia page description? I mean, just look at this, right? Despite being a mountain, Sorrow was in constant state of depression, be it either stern or sad. It had excessively high standards, grafting the benefit of its healing powers only to those it deemed worthy. It also had no qualms about sending children to their death, which it demonstrated by attempting to murder Wicket and Princess Kinesia? Princess Ewok. Like, goddamn, okay. Mount Sorrow has got a lot of shit going on. He only appeared in Ewok's Issue 7, The Perilous Laughing Spell, but then in 2017, in Star Wars Issue 27, in a flashback arc about Yoda, Yoda discovers the Great Mountain, a full-on living mountain, looks straight out of Shadow of the Colossus, and well, beat its ass. Yoda then awakened a bunch of other mountain creatures when the mountain thought all of its people were dead, which resulted in the mountain coming down and living in peace. It's a really weird arc, but I really like it. Just getting this out of the way first, Skippy the Droid's not canon to either Legends or canon. Okay? Okay. Because a lot of people think he is, for whatever reason. Regardless of Skippy's status being canon, there have been some droids in Star Wars that have gained Force sensitivity. Somewhat. For example, the Iron Knights, who were sentient crystals that used battle droid bodies to interact with the world. In these bodies, they would be attached to the Force. You'd think a weird idea like this would be expanded upon more, but no, not really. They only really appear in two stories, Jedi Academy Leviathan in 1999, and Missions 14, The Monsters of Dweem in 1998. And while not Force-sensitive, I thought I'd also mention this. In the comic series Dr. Aphra, in canon, Aphra comes across the Ruh Crystal, which is a vessel for an AI. This crystal was then placed inside of a droid, which caused him to go berserk and slaughter a bunch of people until Vader showed up and destroyed it. So, you know, kind of a sentient droid kind of thing. Okay, so some people got mad that Palpatine returned because it apparently destroyed Anakin's legacy, or like, destroyed the prophecy or whatever. But like in Legends, there's Darth Kytus, Darth Krayt, Darth Warwick III, Darth Strike, Darth Nihil, Darth Talon, Dark Lady the Sith Lumina, Sith Saber Gevar Kai, two Palpatine clones, Vestra Kai, Darth Red, and even Maul's brain ghost hologram thing, if we want to consider that canon. Star Wars Dawn of the Jedi is basically Star Wars Origins. It's chronologically the first piece of Star Wars content and tells the origin of the Jedi and Sith. Honestly, for the most part, the series can't even be recognized as Star Wars because of how uniquely different it is compared to the rest of the franchise. The story is about how the Infinite Empire took control of the galaxy as the first galactic power, as it enslaved species throughout the galaxy, from humans to Twi'leks to Wookiees to Togrutas to even Tusken Raiders. They wielded Force Sabers, which were one of the first versions of a lightsaber. This series is described as the great lost culture of Star Wars, almost like the Atlantis of Star Wars. Like I mentioned previously, it goes over the origin of the Jedi and Sith. Both of them are known as the Jedi at this point in time, and as such are part of the same order. The two split apart once one starts to practice the dark side of the Force while the other practices the light. It's a great series that was sadly cancelled after its third arc once Disney bought Lucasfilm. But hey, at least the Infinite Empire is canon to some extent. Maybe we'll get to see them again sometime. First appearing in the Star Wars Rebels episode, The Call, Purrgil are whale-like creatures that live in the vacuum of space. Not that strange compared to a lot of other things on this iceberg, right? But what if I told you that these bad boys can travel through hyperspace? Yeah, these guys have a natural ability to travel through hyperspace, In fact, their ability was what inspired ancient sentient species in the Star Wars universe to create hyperspace technology. So every time in Star Wars when you see that hyperspace effect, just know that's only there because of whales. So the world between worlds is basically a plane of existence that exists outside of space and time, and allows beings that are able to access it the effect to change the past, and maybe the future? Look, the truth is, we don't really know much about this plane of existence at all, outside of it appearing in one episode of Star Wars Rebels, in which Ezra saves Ahsoka from dying at the hands of Vader. Imagine Vader having to tell Palpatine that.
My master, I failed to kill Skywalker's apprentice.
You went to... No, that's not... That's not the problem. Some kid in a scout trooper outfit came out of a portal and grabbed it right as the temple started falling apart.
What? We also know that the Mortis gods have something to do with it, but we don't know how they're related. A very basic too long didn't read version of it is that it's Star Wars version of time travel. Alright, so now we can talk about Waru. Waru is a transdimensional being hailing from a parallel universe and has the ability to heal injuries. He also has anti-force abilities, too. He's a golden, scaly blob. You know what? I think it's just better if we need to read off his description directly from Wikipedia. Physically, Waru was predominantly a blob-shaped. It consisted of several golden plates acting as shields around a layer of raw, primeval tissue. A thick, syrupy liquid, comparable to ichor, flowed freely from within Waru through the spaces between the covering plates. The inside of Waru was much larger than the outside revealed, allowing three adult humans enough space to swim through. Waru's interior was also breathable by humans. You know, kind of a weird guy, you know, in honesty. He led a cult as he tried to figure out a way back to his own universe, and worked alongside one of Vader's former apprentices, Heather. However, once Heather's plan to sacrifice Anakin Solo to Waru failed, Waru devoured Luke Skywalker, but luckily for Luke, Han and Leia were able to rescue him. So in response, Waru then ate Heather, and then collapsed into himself and disappeared. Yep, he's just kind of gone. Okay. He was only ever mentioned again in two other stories, but because of his sole appearance being the worst Star Wars novel ever, he's become a cult favorite character and has his own satirical fan club. Jackson's a character created for Star Wars Issue 8, 8 for Adobe 3, and was designed to be a homage to Bugs Bunny, though he looks a little similar to Bug O'Hare, just a little bit. He reappeared several more times in the next few issues of the comic, was a mercenary, and was one of the first characters to ever be created for the extended universe. And well, he wasn't really liked. In fact, fans have gone on to call him the Jar Jar Binks of the EU. And so, after a handful of appearances, he was flat out dropped from the comic altogether. And for nearly 20 years, minus a brief cameo in a Clone Wars tie-in comic, he was never brought up. However, when Disney bought Lucasfilm, the first issue of the main Star Wars comic series had a variant cover that paid tribute to Jackson. And a few years later, he was finally brought into canon through the Star Wars Adventures comic series, a comic series aimed more towards children. Ikrit was a Kishibin Jedi Master, a species that looked like a hybrid between a fox and a rabbit, whose fur would change color depending on his mood. You see, he was actually a Jedi prior to the Clone Wars. 400 years prior, to be exact. You see, after failing to rescue some trapped souls, he went into a self-imposed exile, meaning that he missed out on all the fun that was Order 66. He also could use a lightsaber, though he chose not to, because once, he almost murdered his friend with one during training. Hundreds of years later, he joins up with Luke Skywalker's new Jedi Order, and has a blast traveling the galaxy with Anakin Solo, since he was gunned down during the Yuuzhan Vong War. So in canon, the Dianoga who attacked Luke Skywalker in A New Hope in the trash compactor was actually sentient and Force-sensitive. Yup. Her name was Ami, and her story was told in her brief chapter in the anthology book from a certain point of view. She received visions of the Death Star exploding, though she didn't know why, nor did she know what the Force was. In her final moments, she would lift things with her mind in confusion before disintegrating when the Death Star blew up, with her final thoughts wondering what she'd be reincarnated into next. So we all know Palpatine, by extension the Empire, didn't really like non-humans, and so only humans and clones could be stormtroopers. Usually. There were a couple of alien stormtroopers in Legends, like the Tie Sorrel, who only appeared in two issues of the original Star Wars comic, but were allowed to be stormtroopers. But in the years after the Empire, Imperial remnants would generally be more accepting of alien species. For example, the Fell Empire, who were completely fine with having the Tulls, for example, be stormtroopers. If you thought a fox-rabbit hybrid Jedi a Hutt Jedi, and a Ball Jedi were weird. You haven't seen anything yet. Meet Sar Egorn, a rare force-sensitive blob-like creature whose species has never been identified, that's constantly surrounded in green gas. He was a Jedi Master and even trained some Jedi. Imagine you're being assigned your Jedi Master. Instead of some Twi'lek or Chiss, you get Shrek Snot over here. He hasn't actually appeared in any stories, only in source books, like Jedi vs. Sith, The Essential Guide to the Force. So in Legends, they really liked telling a story of who took the Death Star plans. So much so that every time they told the story, it was completely different. There was the time Kyle Katarn did it in Dark Forces. Then there were a group of rebels on the planet Taprawa, who got them in Jedi Dawn. Then there was the Bolton Spynet in Empire at War who did it. Then there were the rebels who broke out of the Death Star's prison system alongside some random Jedi and sent the plans to some rebels in Polis Massa in Battlefront 2. Then there was the Battle of Orin 3, where Biggs Darklighter brought the Death Star plans to a Mon Calamari cruiser that then sent them to the Tantive IV in Star Wars X-Wing. Then there's Rianna Sarin, who stole the plans in Lethal Alliance. There's been so many retcons that eventually it was just confirmed that each of these attempts got small pieces of the plans, and when they were finally put together, it became the Death Star plans seen in A New Hope. There's been so many weird lightsabers over the years, let's just go over a few of them. Dasan, the dinosaur Dark Jedi himself in Jedi Outcast, wielded a standard red lightsaber that had a spike ball at the end of it. Why? Was it so he could hit people with it? I think the blade would be more effective, dude. The light whip is exactly what it sounds like, a lightsaber that acts like a whip. It was primarily used by Sith or Night Sisters, though now in canon, the only person known to use one is Vrnesh D'Rah in the High Republic. Maris Brood in The Force Unleashed used the Guard Shoto lightsabers, which were really their only appearance, though it was made canon with some source books. The Light Club, or Great Lightsaber, was a lightsaber made for giant sentient aliens. Basically, it was just a giant lightsaber. It was also made canon through some source books. So Ezra Bridger's first lightsaber in Star Wars Rebels was a unique lightsaber blaster hybrid that could shoot stun blasts at enemies when not in lightsaber mode. Kylo Ren's crossguard saber isn't actually the only version of the crossguard lightsaber. Before that was introduced into canon, in Legends, the crossguard saber was a forked lightsaber that had two blades, the standard blade and one that was angled 45 degrees from the main blade. The lightfoil was a small and elegant version of the lightsaber that only appeared in The Last Jedi. No, not the movie, the Legends novel. There's the lightsaber rifle, which is a rifle that's powered by a lightsaber crystal, and it looks sick as hell. There's the sickle-bladed lightsaber only seen in the anthology novel Dark Legends. There's the proto-saber, which was one of the first kinds of lightsabers, although in order to use it, you needed to power the blade with a generator you wore as a backpack. Then there's Wardnall's giant lightsaber. He's not a giant alien species, so I guess he just built it because it looked cool with his armor, which, I mean, fair enough, it does. Then, of course, is the Darksaber, which everyone knows about now. It's been wielded by Pre Vizsla, Din Djarin, Darth Maul, Bo-Katan, Moff Gideon, Gar Saxon, and my wife Sabine Wren. The Ujian Vong are a species outside of the known Star Wars galaxy that refused to use mechanical technology. Instead, they used bio-organic tech. They were a species that invaded the Star Wars universe that required the entire galaxy to unite just to fight them off. I'd argue that the Ujian Vong War is the biggest event in Legends just for how devastating it was. I mean, their war caused the deaths of 365 trillion. They were ultra-religious, or all masochists, it couldn't be sensed with a force. That last part irked George Lucas, however, as when the Ujian Vong were meant to make an appearance in the Clone Wars, George Lucas requested that they get rid of the whole force immunity stuff. There's currently a similar species to them in canon called the Grisk, who appear in the Thrawn Saga, which are obviously the canon versions of the Vong, but at the moment they share no similarities outside of wanting to invade the galaxy. Oh my god, it's almost over. Tier 3 is finally almost over. Alright, so Splinter in the Mind's Eye is the first installment in the Star Wars Expanded Universe and was published in 1978. This book was written as a treatment for a sequel to A New Hope, one with a much lower budget. In the story, Luke, Leia, R2, and 3PO crash land on a swamp planet that's under occupation from the Empire. There, they're forced to disguise themselves as miners, have serious sexual tension between each other, gross, and discover a force-sensitive old lady, and get locked up in prison. Oh, and Luke and Leia have a play fight in some mud. Ooh, don't care for that at all. Nope, don't care for that one bit. Vader then shows up and Luke duels him, but is defeated. Leia then picks up Luke's blade, and then duels Vader, but then is defeated as well. Then Obi-Wan Kenobi's ghost comes in and possesses Luke, and then fights and defeats Vader. This novel is pretty strange, and like I said earlier, was a treatment for a sequel to A New Hope in case A New Hope failed, and didn't make any money, which is why Han Solo is absent from the novel, because George didn't know if Harrison Ford would come back. But when A New Hope was such a massive hit, The Empire Strikes Back was greenlit. Later, in 1995, a comic adaptation would be released.
Puppy?
Is this your ball? You want your ball? Okay.
Oh, yeah. No, here. All right. I still got it. You want your ball? I got it. Yeah. Here we go. Go get it. Go get your ball.
As many already know, Alec Guinness hated working on Star Wars. He complained that his dialogue was terrible, and even said that Obi-Wan wasn't even bearable to play. He also hated the conditions of filming, and hated being remembered for his appearance in the original trilogy. He hated the franchise so much that when a young kid asked him for his autograph and claimed he'd seen Star Wars countless times, Alec Guinness agreed to his autograph only if the kid never watched the film again. The kid started crying, and the mother called him a nasty man. Meanwhile, Harrison Ford, one of the greatest actors of all time, also doesn't really like Star Wars, though he probably doesn't care for the films because he doesn't really like the character of Han Solo. He even begged George Lucas to kill him off in Empire. I mean, hell, that's the only reason he agreed to come back for Force Awakens, is that they killed him off. It's also clear he's just tired of answering Star Wars questions. I mean, the dude has played Han Solo in 5 films, well, 4 plus a cameo in 1, versus 40 years of countless films. The 4.5 Indiana Jones films, both Blade Runners, Air Force One, The Fugitive, Patriot Games, both American Graffitis, Apocalypse Now. Hell, I bet the guy would even rather get questions nowadays about Expendables 3 or Cowboys and Aliens than get another question about Star Wars. Alright, so real quick, you can see the Millennium Falcon in Revenge of the Sith. George Lucas himself confirmed that that's the Falcon, and was in the film to further tie the original trilogy and prequel trilogies together. So there's been a bunch of cameos in Star Wars. Rian Johnson cameos as a weapon technician in Rogue One, Gareth Edwards cameos in Rogue One as well, as the rebel soldier who detaches the Tantive IV, and as a resistance soldier on Crait in The Last Jedi. Daniel Craig cameoed as the mind trick stormtrooper in The Force Awakens, George Lucas and his daughter cameoed in Revenge of the Sith as Baron Papin Noida and his daughter, and John Williams cameoed in Rise of Skywalker as Oma Tress. In The Phantom Menace, you can see an alien species called Asgoyan, who are modeled after E.T. from the film E.T. Indiana Jones and Star Wars have a bit of a history together, due to them being both made by Lucasfilm. In Star Wars, Indiana Jones shows up in the LEGO Star Wars The Complete Saga to promote his own game. He then shows up in the non-canon Star Wars comic Into the Great Unknown, where Han Solo crash lands on Earth and gets killed by Native Americans, and then Chewbacca becomes Bigfoot. The Lost Ark, Golden Idol, and Crystal Skull all show up several times in Star Wars, as does the Staff of Ra. And in the game Star Wars Yoda Stories, you can actually meet Indiana Jones. Meanwhile, in Indiana Jones, Star Wars characters show up in LEGO Indiana Jones The Original Avengers, including Han Solo, who's playable. R2 and 3PO appeared in Raiders of the Lost Ark on the wall, and Han Solo is a playable skin in Indiana Jones and the Staff of Kings. In The Empire Strikes Back, one of the asteroids in the asteroid field that the Falcon flies through is actually a potato. There's even a nod to this Easter egg in Attack of the Clones, as one of the asteroids in that film was actually just an expanded cow. Did you know there's a tennis shoe hidden in the Battle of Endor? Where is it? I have no idea. All we know is that it's there somewhere, but even Ken Ralston, the visual effects artist on Return of the Jedi, has said he has no idea where it is. I guess it's just some background ship in the far distance. Apparently there's also a yogurt container too. So to promote Star Wars Connect, Chris Pratt was hired to play Obi-Wan Kenobi in like a haha funny commercial for the game. You know, everyone was worried about Chris Pratt replacing Harrison Ford as Indiana Jones, but nobody expected Chris Pratt to replace Ian McGregor. Almost all the weapons from the original trilogy were made from surplus World War II weapons. For example, Han's DLO-44 is made from a Mauser C-96. The E-11 blaster used by the Empire is made from the Sten. In A New Hope, the Jawa that shoots R2 uses an ion cannon that's made of a sawed-off Lee Enfield rifle. The T-21 used by the Empire is made from the Lewis. The Defender's sporting blaster pistol used by Leia is based on the 22MT target pistol. The DLT-19 is based on the MG-34. And Boba Fett's EE-3 carbine blaster is based on the Webley Cerberus revolver. In 2015, Sam Witwer, the voice of Galen Merrick in Starkiller, did 3 developer commentary streams while playing The Force Unleashed. He did this along with David Collins and other developers in the game. They talk about the production of the game, like voice acting, designs, lore, behind-the-scenes stories, and overall fun stories just working at LucasArts. And later in 2017, they did a 4th one. I highly recommend these to anyone who likes The Force Unleashed. They're amazing. Originally, Yoda was going to be played by a monkey. The monkey was even screen tested for the role and taught how to hold Yoda's cane. This was because George Lucas thought the animatronics and puppetry wouldn't be realistic enough to convince viewers to taking Yoda seriously. But the puppet was eventually brought back after animal handlers couldn't trade the monkey well enough. Because Leia's bikini slave outfit was held together by metal framework, it didn't move very well with the rest of her costume. Because of this, there were several times while filming that they had to reshoot scenes because of wardrobe malfunctions. Kay Fisher even stated that she hated wearing the costume and referred to it as what supermodels will eventually wear in the 7th Ring of Hell. She also mentioned it was very revealing to the rest of the crew. Jeremy Bullock, the guy who played Boba Fett, stated that they could see more of Carrie Fisher than they could tell she was comfortable with. Return of the Ewok is one of the rare cases of lost Star Wars media. It's a 24-minute documentary about the behind-the-scenes of Return of the Jedi that starred Warwick Davis as Wicket. He travels around the set and meets with many of the film's cast and crew, before eventually traveling to the world of Star Wars and is chased down by Boba Fett and the Death Star. This short was going to be released to promote Return of the Jedi, but post-production was never completed. And so for years, the footage that was recorded was thought to be lost, but eventually Warwick Davis gave Lucasfilm his copy of the film so that they could make their own copy. Lucasfilm would then release small clips of it as DVD extras and on their official website. However, to this day, the entire film has never been released outside of screenings held at the first 3 Star Wars celebrations. I'm putting this in right now as I'm ending this. Return of the Ewok was actually found, kinda. Fans put together the footage that were released through DVDs and on the website, along with VHS bootleg copies of the screening from the first 3 Star Wars celebrations. So it is technically not lost, but it's never been officially released by Lucasfilm, period. So Palpatine the Rise of Skywalker poster isn't actually Palpatine from the film, or even from Return of the Jedi. It's the Hot Toys figure of Palpatine photoshopped into the poster. Some people were like really mad at this, but I don't know, I just found it funny. So just like with every movie, many different actors auditioned for the roles in Star Wars. Some of them included Vinette Robinson as Padme, Benedict Del Toro as Maul, Michael Jackson as Jar Jar Binks, he dodged a bullet there, Gary Oldman as General Grievous, Paul Walker and Leonardo DiCaprio as Anakin Skywalker, Christopher Walken, Robert Englund, and Sylvester Stallone as Han Solo, Tupac as Mace Windu, Jodie Foster and Karen Allen as Princess Leia, Orson Welles as the voice of Darth Vader, Billy Lord as Rey, and Michael Fassbender as Kylo Ren. Honestly, I think the best way to explain how Mace Windu got his purple lightsaber is just to show you the behind-the-scenes clip.
I figured out who we had to talk to about your light color, your lightsaber color.
Oh, well, good guys are green and blue, bad guys are red. That's just the way it works.
No purple left?
You might get purple.
Because there are so many Star Wars games out there, I can't go over all their console differences, so I'm just going to do the ones I know the most about, or I've played. The Force Unleashed PS2, Wii, and PSP ports are all completely different. These 3 versions followed the same story as the main version, but with added levels on Bespin, Coruscant, and had a completely different opening to the game. But even these ports had exclusive features each. Like the PS2 port had no unique features. The PSP version had a ladder mode where you'd fight enemies in waves that get harder and harder, along with bonus levels that were based on scenes in the original saga. You'd also play as a ton of different characters. And the Wii version had an actual fighting game built into it. Oh, and there's also the iOS version that's basically lost media now. In this, Galen Merrick kills Coda, and that's really all I know about it. The Wii port of Force Unleashed 2 got an extra level in the game. This level should have probably been in the main game because of how short that game was. It also featured a fighting game built into it. The DS version of Revenge of the Sith, the game, was an entirely different game that featured really good looking 2D graphics. The DS version of Elite Squadrons used a dungeon crawler camera instead of a first or third person camera and features 4-player multiplayer. And only 4-player multiplayer. You can't fight against bots. And finally, there's the LEGO games on the Game Boy Advance, which are played at an angle instead of the normal LEGO games, and you can only play by yourself. There's no 2-player option. According to Mark Hamill, in order to keep the twist of The Empire Strikes Back a secret, George Lucas, Mark Hamill, and Ivan Kershner, director of Empire, were the only three to know the secret. When the scene was shot, Vader's line was, "You don't know the truth. Obi-Wan killed your father." And this was later redubbed into the iconic father line. Empire of Dreams is a 2004 documentary about the making of the original trilogy, and it's easily one of my favorite documentaries of all time, if not my favorite. It goes over George Lucas's beginnings as a director all the way to the impact Star Wars has made across the world. I originally watched this years ago when I was 10 and loved it, but forgot the name of it. Luckily, it's on Disney Plus now, so I rewatched it and it's just as good as I remembered. Check it out as soon as possible. In The Phantom Menace, in the scene where Palpatine meets Anakin on Naboo, you can see some Jedi behind them, like Plo Koon, Ki-Adi-Mundi, Eeth Koth, and Mace Windu? No, that can't be. That's not Sam Jackson. Well, it actually is him. Apparently, this scene was a very late addition to the film, and they couldn't get Sam Jackson to come back for the reshoots. Mace Windu in this scene was actually played by Oliver Wilson, who was Sam Jackson's stunt double and body double for the prequels. Also, a website in 1999 was made exclusively about this scene. No, I'm not joking. The Director of the Jedi is a documentary created while The Last Jedi was being made. It tells the story of Rian Johnson and the crew creating the film and shows how much time Rian Johnson spent studying the franchise and delving into the lore. It also details how Mark Hamill was conflicted about the character of Luke Skywalker, though by the end of it he learned to accept that this is the character's destiny, and he respects the decision and Rian Johnson himself. It's an amazing documentary and I highly recommend it. Only problem is that it's not on Disney Plus yet. The fuck, you guys have the Fantastic Four cartoon on here, but not this? A New Hope wasn't even remotely the first draft of Star Wars. In fact, the drafts that came before it were extremely different. In 1973, George Lucas created the Star Wars story synopsis. In this draft, Star Wars takes place in our universe in the 33rd century. Civil War is broken across the galaxy as General Luke Skywalker escorts the princess as they flee from the Empire. They land on the planet Gordon, which is basically Tatooine, but leave the planet once they can make contact with the Resistance. The rest of the film deals with Luke and the rebels and farmers performing guerrilla attacks on Imperial outposts and freeing prisoners. This story treatment was heavily inspired by the Vietnam War that was still going on at the time, and was pretty much in favor of the Viet Cong and anti-American involvement. George Lucas later stated he couldn't make this film because of the controversy that would have ensued. The next draft was the Star Wars Rough Draft, which followed Kane Starkiller as he travels the galaxy after killing the Sith assassin that murdered his son, Deke Starkiller. In this adventure, he meets up with General Luke Skywalker, Han, Princess Leia, Chewbacca, 3PO, and R2, and they, along with a group of Wookiees, battle the Empire and destroy the Empire's battle station. It's a lot more to the story, but you can read it for yourself because this draft actually got turned into a comic series in 2013 through 2014 by Dark Horse Comics. And finally, in 1975, we have the most well-known draft, The Adventures of Starkiller, Saga 1, The Star Wars. This one is very similar to the story we got, except for a few major differences. The first being that Deke Starkiller is the protagonist, and he lives on the planet Utapau, with his family Big Starkiller, Leia Lars, Windy Starkiller, Owen and Beru, who were both Jedi in this draft. Some more differences include a visit to Alderaan's floating cities, which later became Bespin, the attack on the Death Star, consisting of mostly Y-Wings instead of X-Wings, and yes, Stormtroopers were rocking those lightsabers. In the fourth episode of the second season of The Mandalorian, The Siege, in a brief scene, you can see a member of the show's cast in the background wearing jeans. After fans noticed it, Disney re-edited the episode to remove Jeans Guy. Even though he was removed, he's become an iconic Star Wars character since. Jeans Guy isn't the only error made in Star Wars, far from it. There's of course the iconic head-bumping stormtrooper that's been parodied to hell and back, even by Star Wars themselves. In the shot where Finn is holding an injured Rey in The Force Awakens, you can briefly see Rey move her own leg, even though she's supposed to be unconscious. Obi-Wan briefly uses Anakin's lightsaber, Revenge of the Sith. You can see Obi-Wan's lightsaber wires in A New Hope. And most recently in the Bad Batch trailer, you can actually see Hunter's hand clip through Omega's hand. There's still a bunch more, but I'd be here all day if I were to list all of them off. Ken Nightingale was a boom mic operator who worked on Star Wars. Decades after the film was released, he became extremely popular in the Star Wars fanbase after a picture of him surfaced in 2015 of him working on Star Wars in 1976 wearing nothing but pink shorts. Though sadly, on May 19, 2020, he passed away at the age of 92 due to COVID-19. Disney Gallery The Mandalorian was a documentary series that told the behind the scenes of every episode in the first season of The Mandalorian. It was pretty well received, so it got a second season. And by second season, I mean a 1-hour special to cover the entirety of season 2. Wish we got an entire episode about the Krayt Dragon, Luke, the Dark Troopers, but okay. I guess that'll do.
I can't get this open.
Allow me to help you, young one. May the fries be with you.
Star Wars Episode 3 toys are now at Burger King. There are 31 different toys you can collect. You can wind up General Grievous, race around with the Millennium Falcon, or make Yoda do a backflip. There's one in every kid's meal, only at Burger King.
We now return to the all-new Ewoks.
Star Wars Line Webtoon is a Korean comic that retold the events of the original trilogy, released from 2015 to 2016. It went on for 40 issues and was made to promote The Force Awakens, as its original title was literally translated to Star Wars Story Before Force Awakens. William Shakespeare's Star Wars is a series of non-canon Star Wars novels released from 2013 to 2020 that retold the events of all 9 Skywalker films in the style of Shakespeare. An interesting idea, but after high school, there's no amount of money that will ever get me to read these books. I'm sorry, I just can't do Shakespeare again. No thanks, I'm gonna have to pass. Darth Jar Jar is an insane fan theory that originates back in 2015 by the Reddit user Lumpawaru, and it has a lot of evidence backing it up. The theory states that Jar Jar Binks was the true antagonist of the prequel trilogy, though because of fan backlash, his role was reduced, though traces of him being a Sith Lord still remain in the Phantom Menace and Attack of the Clones. But you know what the craziest thing is? This was kind of confirmed to be true. In response to the theory, Amon Best, the actor for Jar Jar, tweeted out, "I will say this, it feels really good when the hidden meaning behind the work is seen, no matter how long it takes." And then further talked about it in an interview where he said, "There's a lot about the theory that is true. There are some things about it that aren't true. Could Jar Jar evolve into that? I think the answer is yes." Because of the backlash, and rightfully so, Lucasfilm backed off with Jar Jar a lot. But a lot of the influence that I put into the character mirrored a lot of what was already in the Star Wars universe. He even said that it was a deleted scene that was never filmed in Attack of the Clones, where Palpatine tells Jar Jar about his plans for the Empire. And most recently, J.J. Abrams even personally approved of this theory. So I guess Jar Jar might have been a Sith Lord if he wasn't so hated in The Phantom Menace. In promotion for The Force Unleashed, the game Soul Calibur 4 made a deal with LucasArts to include Darth Vader, Yoda, and Starkiller as playable fighters. There was even a tie-in comic called Star Wars Visions of the Blade that's obviously non-canon. To promote the prequel trilogy, Darth Maul appears as a playable character in Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 3. While in Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 4, you play as Jango Fett. One can only imagine the guest character they might have gotten if they made a fifth game around that time. General Grievous, maybe? Anakin? That one battle droid that knew he was going to die but still kept fighting at the end of Revenge of the Sith? Who knows? Maybe even pregnant Padme would have shredded in. So in 2018, Sam Jackson started claiming Mace Windu could have survived Revenge of the Sith and wanted to play him again in an anthology film set after Episode 3. His argument is that we've seen Jedi fall from great heights and survive before, but I mean, dude, your hand got cut off and got blasted with lightning and then fell off a trillion-story building. You're pretty much dead. Maul did get cut in half. Boba Fett got vored. And Palpatine exploded. Shit, I guess he could still be alive. The Strategic Defense Initiative is a proposed missile defense system intended to protect the United States from ballistic missiles, announced in 1983 by President Ronald Reagan. It was nicknamed the Star Wars program, but Ted Kennedy called it a reckless Star Wars scheme. It required the U.S. to create a wide array of lasers and particle beams that could be used to destroy the missiles. Does it have anything to actually do with Star Wars? No.
No more Star Wars!
In 1983, the United States Department of Health and Human Services aired a smoking PSA that featured C-3PO walking in on R2-D2 smoking. Despite not having organs, 3PO tells R2 that he should set good examples for humans. R2 clearly did not listen to him.
I almost fell. You get your chance alone!
There's a popular theory that Padme didn't actually die from lacking the will to live, which honestly was always really dumb to me. Instead, Palpatine was telling Anakin the truth, and that he knew how to prevent people from dying. He used the Force to move Padme's life force into Anakin in order for him to survive. Maybe Anakin was actually dead when Palpatine found him on Mustafar, and when he goes, he still lives, was him just moments after beginning the process of transporting her life force into him. If this is true, it would be mirrored in The Rise of Skywalker when Ben brings Rey back to life using his own life force. I personally love this theory and consider it to be canon. Mercenaries Playground of Destruction is a 2005 third-person shooter where you can play as Han Solo and Indiana Jones. Because of this, now we have images of Han Solo with real-life assault rifles gunning people down. Didn't know I needed that. Star Wars Force of Destiny was a micro-series released in 2017 and 2018 that had 36 episodes, and was hated? Yeah, a lot of grown men really hate this show for some weird reason. Like, they go, ugh, feminism! But it's just about female characters in Star Wars. I thought you guys liked them. Like, there's nothing here that pushes feminism. And even then, there's still dudes in the show. Hell, there's an episode that's just about Luke and Yoda, for example. Like, I don't... Okay. God forbid little girls get Star Wars content. You know, fucking hell. Anyways, there's actually some neat lore stuff added to the franchise because of the series. Like Hera interacting with the original trilogy cast, Padme having her own personal N1 starfighter, a new Vulture droid variant that as of now still isn't named, Princess Nezia from the Ewoks cartoon makes her first canon appearance, as do the Gorax. There's even two different lightsaber duels in the series. Granted, they're both lightsaber training duels, but oh well. Oh, and Mark Hamill plays Luke in two episodes. Is the animation all that great? No, not really, but it's a micro-series, so if you're expecting Clone Wars, Rebels, or Resistance animation, I don't know what to tell you. Anakin does look horrible, though, I will give you that. Mimas is one of Saturn's moons and was discovered in 1789. It's one of the smallest moons of the entire solar system, and in 1980 it was discovered to have a giant crater on the side of it that makes the moon look exactly like the Death Star. So people tend to refer to this moon as the Death Star Moon. Connect Star Wars to the last game developed by LucasArts before their closure. In this, you take control of your own personal Jedi as you battle through the Clone Wars. This game exclusively uses the Xbox Kinect system, which has made this game notable for being one of the worst games ever made, as the game is barely responsive. There's a bunch of game modes in this game, though, outside of the story mode, like Rancor Rampage, Pod Racing, Duel of Fates, and yes, Galactic Dance Off. In this, there's a bunch of parodies of real world songs, and it plays just like a Just Dance game. It features such iconic songs as Empire Today, We No Speak Huttese, Hologram Girl, and of course... Before Force Unleashed 2's fighting game mode, there was Clone Wars lightsaber duels. And before that, there was the Force Unleashed fighting game mode. And before that, was Revenge of the Sith's fighting game mode. And before that, was a canceled fighting game that I forgot to mention earlier, but look, here it is. Please don't comment below about how I missed it. But even before that, there was Star Wars Masters of Terras Kai, a fighting game that's notable for being just horrible. Released in 1997 for the PlayStation 1, you play as all your favorite characters, like Luke, Han, Leia, Chewbacca, Hor, Thawk, Ardrian Lynn. There's even secret characters like Vader, Mara Jade, Stormtrooper, Jodo Cast, and Leia again, but this time in her slave outfit. So if you thought Star Wars Battlefront Elite Squadron was the most obscure Battlefront game, you haven't seen anything yet. There's of course Renegade Squadron, which I played a ton of back in the day on the PSP. There's also Mobile Squadrons, which was released exclusively for cell phones, and yes, that's Denil of all characters on the cover. There's Battlefront Mobile, which I literally cannot find an image of outside of the cover art. It's released in 2005 for cell phones, and I think it might actually just be lost media. And finally, there's Star Wars Battlefront 2015's companion app that I do not understand. Much like Transformers and Rio, Angry Birds crossed over with Star Wars with two games, the first being released in 2012 based on the original trilogy, while the second one was released a year later in 2013 and was based on the prequel trilogy. Besides the games, there's been plush toys, console ports for both portable and home consoles, toys, and books. Okay, so hear me out. I don't think Galen Merrick died in The Force Unleashed. My evidence? Well, one, while we see Galen Merrick's corpse in The Force Unleashed 2, how do we know it's actually him? I mean, the last outfit Galen wore before he supposedly died were those Jedi robes. Why is he now wearing his apprentice outfit? Did Vader undress him? No, of course he didn't. Two, why is it that there's only been two successful clones, Starkiller and the Dark Apprentice? Kamino's cloned Jedi before, I mean look at X1 and X2. And before you go, well Pikmin, that game was released after The Force Unleashed 2. Nope, Elite Squadrons came out in 2009, while Force Unleashed 2 was made in 2010. LucasArts knew about cloning Jedi. So think about it. Why were there a bunch of failed clones? Simple. Vader had the Kaminos clone the living Galen Merrick to create an army of Sith soldiers. Galen Merrick had lost his memories after the events of the first game, so Vader decided to try and use him again, since, you know, the dude 1v1 Palpatine. The Dark Apprentice is the only real clone of Galen Merrick that ever gained sentience. Vader was testing to see if the Dark Apprentice would be loyal or not. And three... I mean, come on. You do a clone storyline, and you're constantly dropping the, wait, are you even a clone? Don't kill Vader, he's the only one that knows if Starkiller really survived! Like, it's storytelling 101. It's very obvious in the third game. It would have been revealed Starkiller isn't a clone. Also, Sam Witwer said in a stream once that, like, he refuses to answer the question if he was a clone or not, and it's like, why would he do that if it was even a question? Like, come on, it's kind of obvious. In episode 417 of The Muppets, released in 1980, had the cast of The Muppets cross over with the cast of Star Wars, specifically Mark Hamill as Luke, Anthony Daniels as C-3PO, Peter Mayhew as Chewbacca, and R2-D2. During the episode, there are skits about Star Wars, including one involving Darth Vader parody known as Darth Nader. In the final moments of the episode, Mark Hamill meets Luke Skywalker, as Kermit just kind of stands there like, how did you... what? Return of the Jedi Ewok Adventure was a 1983 shoot-'em-up made for the Atari 2600. The game had you play as an Ewok using a hang glider to destroy AT-STs and stormtroopers while also dodging trees. The game was completely finished, but was never released because the company considered the game to be too hard. So you're probably wondering now, why isn't this in Tier 2? Well, it's because this game was unofficially released. In 1997, a prototype cartridge surfaced and was sold for $1,600. Because of this, now it's imported to the PC, so now you can play it for free on the Internet Archive. So a lot of people were theorizing who Snoke could be. A lot of people said he was Darth Plagueis, even though Pablo Hidalgo debunked that theory in May 2016, almost an entire year before The Last Jedi came out, so I don't know why people were shocked about that. Then there were people claiming he was Ezra Bridger. But then they realized it can't be, and they moved on to this one background character in Rogue One, who must be Ezra. Well, I guess not anymore. Some people even thought Snoke was Mace Windu, or Grand Moff Tarkin. Okay? Turns out, though, I was right. Snoke was... Snoke. Before someone says, well, actually, he's technically Palpatine because he controlled it. No. No, it's just not true. That's just objectively not true. So everyone knows about Star Wars Galaxies and Star Wars The Republic. But what if I was to tell you there was an entire Star Wars MMO released in between these two other MMOs? Well, Star Wars The Clone Wars Adventures released in 2010. In this, you can create your own character and explore the era of the Clone Wars, play minigames, battle Jedi or Sith, or participate in large, full-scale battles. However, despite the success it had, the game was shut down in 2014, along with three other MMOs. So there's a theory about Anakin and Padme's relationship that would kind of change everyone's opinion on Anakin if it was true. The theory states that Anakin was mind-tricking Padme throughout Attack of the Clones to get her to love him. The evidence is that suddenly she wants to do everything he wants to do, and is completely okay with Anakin telling her how he just slaughtered a bunch of Tusken Raider kids. But guys, I don't think George Lucas was making Anakin a rapist. I think he just didn't write their romance very well in that film. I don't know, just a hunch. You know, it just makes more sense to me than Anakin being a rapist. You know, I'm just throwing that out there. In 2007, an episode of Family Guy parodied A New Hope to critical acclaim. 3 years later, in 2010, they released one based on The Empire Strikes Back, and finally, in 2011, one for Return of the Jedi. For the most part, these are pretty well received. For the most part. I personally like the first two installments, but the Jedi parody was kind of eh to me. Meanwhile, Robot Chicken also created a Star Wars tribute episode in 2007, which was followed up by another one in 2008, and another one in 2010. So I, along with most Star Wars fans, need a fit-in Poe Disney Plus series where they just hang out traveling the galaxy fighting bad dudes. But some people wanted a bit more. Some people shipped the two characters, and surprisingly, the actors knew about this ship. In fact, Oscar Isaac apparently tried to push for a relationship between the two characters. He stated, "I think there could have been a very interesting forward-thinking, not even forward-thinking, just like current-thinking love story there. Something that hadn't been quite explored yet, particularly the dynamic between these two men in a war that they could have fallen in love with each other. I would try to push a bit in that direction, but the Disney overlords were not ready to do that." In 1978, Lucasfilm released the first ever Star Wars spin-off film, set between the events of A New Hope and Empire Strikes Back, called The Holiday Special, and it's known as one of the worst films ever made. It's got a lot of problems, like how it's mostly about Wookiees with no subtitles. Poor acting from just about everyone. Short films that go on forever, like the one involving a how-to build section for a fake radio thing or whatever, using fake parts. What's the point of this? This has no practical use. This special's been parodied to hell and back, and George Lucas himself even stated that if he had the time and resources, he'd go around and destroy every copy of this film. Since then, Lucasfilm has been pretty hesitant to bring up this film. Though it's gotten better in the last few years, with the Boba Fett animated short being put on Disney+, the LEGO Star Wars Holiday Special being a spiritual successor to it, to even Disney even greenlighting a Guardians of the Galaxy Holiday Special. So there's a fan theory that Boba Fett was the one that killed Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru in A New Hope. This is because he was added to the film in the special edition, and in Empire Strikes Back, Vader tells Boba Fett not to disintegrate people, as a possible reference to Owen and Beru being burnt alive. But this theory got debunked, because we know who killed them. Some dude named Mod. Okay, so this is a real quick, dumb one. In 2008, the UK company HMV released the Clone Wars episode Downfall of a Droid as an exclusive preview episode as its own DVD. I need this DVD. Imagine buying a DVD that contains only one single episode on it. So this is a theory that's not even really a theory. It's more like it's confirmed. Ewoks eat people. Yep. All those helmets you see being used as drums at the end of Return of the Jedi? Ewoks ate all the bodies. I mean, we even got confirmation of this in Forces of Destiny, of all things. Don't fuck with Ewoks, I guess. So in December of 2019, the same month Rise of Skywalker was released, Burger King in Germany decided to release commercials where they flat out just leaked the entire film's plot. No joke, the idea of these commercials was literally like, ooh, try not to be spoiled. But they get spoiled anyways. And these aren't like fake leaks. They revealed that Hux was the spy in it, for example. It's just insane to me that Lucasfilm even remotely let this happen. Star Wars Infinities is a non-canon what-if comic trilogy that began in 2001 and ended in 2004. The first installment tells the story of what would have happened if Luke missed his shot in the Death Star on A New Hope. The second installment tells the story about what if Luke died on Hoth during The Empire Strikes Back. And the third installment tells the story of what would have happened if Leia had set off the thermal detonator in Jabba's palace in Return of the Jedi. These comics are notable for some insane stuff happening, like Leia becoming a Sith Lord, Vader becoming redeemed and wearing a pure white version of his armor, Yoda starts to train Leia in the ways of the Force, Yevon 4 gets destroyed, and oh yeah, Yoda drives the fucking Death Star into a planet. It's an insanely entertaining comic series that I wish continued. Imagine if they did one for the prequels and sequel trilogies. Like, what if Maul killed Obi-Wan, not Qui-Gon? Or what if Obi-Wan did join Dooku? Or what if Han convinced Ben to rejoin the Light? I love what if stories like this.
Coming up next, it's Star Wars The Clone Wars on Cartoon Network.
Hey, pick on someone your own size.
The Star Wars trilogy is back on the big screen, and it's even better with a Pepsi.
Great effects, man.
Yeah.
We now continue with drawings.
Hello, I am Research Droid 527077, but you may refer to me as 77. I'm in charge of dealing with historical records in our universe, so if you have any questions, feel free to ask, but not too many. Many Jedi have reported seeing alternate realities in which events in our galaxy play out very differently. There is one in which Luke Skywalker becomes the Grand Master of the Jedi Order and faces off against threats like Abeloth of Yu Zhongmong, a universe in which Galen Merrick murdered Vader and corrupted the young Skywalker child, a universe in which Vader overcame the high ground and slaughtered both his former and current masters, a universe in which the Dark Entity kills the daughter of Anakin in the final hours of the Galactic Civil War, a universe in which Katarn's apprentice becomes the greatest threat to the galaxy, and a universe in which Kylo Katarn becomes the Dark Lord of the Sith. Reports of Darth Tyrannus, or Count Dooku, survival have been heard from Rex's Prime all the way to Vos Pity. They say the Count's head has been kept alive by his hatred for his former master, and so now he has connected himself with the robot's body in hopes that one day he shall slay his former master. The name Skywalker always ends in tragedy. Shmi ended up being murdered by Tusken Raiders, Anakin turning into Darth Vader, Luke living his life in exile, and Ben becoming a puppet to Vader's legacy. As soon as Rey took the name Skywalker, she doomed herself to a horrible future. The entity she faced in the ruins of the Death Star, instead it was her from the future coming back in time in a vain attempt at killing her before she could take the path of the Sith. The events that have occurred in this universe are occurring in the same timeline as Earth, a planet in which will host the human race many, many years into the future, in a galaxy far, far away, according to some historians. Grandmaster Yoda realized that the Jedi of the Clone Wars were corrupt and a shadow of what they were. He sensed Palpatine's plans ages ago, but ignored them in an act of restarting the Jedi Order, cleaning the slate, if you will. There have been rumors that Palpatine was not in control of his own actions, but when he killed his master's spirit took hold of Palpatine, because of the research he had done into immortality, and thus the Palpatine we knew was not actually him, but Darth Plagueis reborn. The events in our galaxy have led some to believe that war is and always should be the answer. Murder and raining hellfire upon villages should be the lesson we get from our history of stories telling people about peace, love, and fighting for the right of others. Very illogical. According to neo-imperialists, the Empire was actually in the right. They say that hate Palpatine for all you want for his bigoted beliefs, but he did create a perfect economy. They also claim that the Jedi genocide was fake, or that it simply didn't happen to the extent official records claim. Alright, we're done. If you made it to the end of the video, massive props, thank you. This went out of control. This was meant to be like an hour and 20 max, but the more information I got that I'm like, oh, I forgot this and that. And then it kept going and going and going. And, you know, I guess Star Wars is the best franchise for it. These are my favorite franchises, as I mentioned at the beginning of the video. I absolutely love the franchise. I adore it. It's unfortunate that it's been filled with toxicity lately, as with the Phantom Menace and all these reactionary channels and all that. I can't wait for the comments. I cannot wait for the comments because I know for a fact, you know, most of them will be little nice little comments or whatever. Maybe some criticism of the audio, which is fine. I agree if my audio is not very good. But there's gonna be like at least like 6 or 7, maybe even like 10 comments going like, at an hour and 35 minutes and 22 seconds, you stated that like reactionaries online are stupid, or like at 2 hours and 10 minutes and 29 seconds, you stated how like the Phantom Menace was cringe, and you're a really fucked up, and it's like. It's like the Batman video. I mention things that aren't even remotely political, and then people get fucking apeshit over it for no fucking reason. It's great. That's what the Joker is Triggered video was. If for those that actually watched that video, it was a reading of some fucking loon's reaction to me saying something that wasn't political at all. It was very silly. Very silly. But yeah, thank you for watching. I'm going to keep making iceberg videos. None of them will ever be this long again. None of them will ever be this long again. Believe me, I don't want to do it again. And if you didn't like the formats of this, where it's like there's each tier is a topic instead of like obscurity, don't worry. It will go back to, you know, the standard iceberg stuff with the next one, which I'll say the next one is about the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So if you're interested in that, there you go. And I guess I should announce a couple things. I don't want to normally announce icebergs because, like, I have like a bad feeling like someone might jump in and be like, I'm going to take your idea and whatever. But it's like, I don't care. At this point, I don't care. Plus, it's the end of the video. And like 5% of you people who click on this video will actually get to the end. After the Marvel Cinematic Universe one, I'm going to do a Spider-Man one, then a Halo one. I might do a Lego one day because someone mentioned that, and the more I thought about it, I'm like, it's a good idea. I like that idea. I want to do stuff for certain anime franchises. Like, I'm a huge Fate fan, which is why there's that Fate reference in the Transformers one. But Type Moon, actually just Japanese companies in general, are really pissy about like music being used and all that kind of stuff. So I don't know if I could even do that. I'll see. Maybe a Steins Gate one. I'm a big fan of Steins Gate. We'll see. You know, we'll see. And like I said, I'm going to make other content as well. Actually, the next video will not be an expert video. It's going to be like a more of a comedy thing. It should be interesting. I want to make it for a while now. Just been busy. But yeah, I hope you enjoyed. Subscribe if you want to. It's your choice. Like it. I mean, it's your choice again. Whatever. I'm not going to beg for that kind of stuff. This is just a hobby. And yeah, if you're watching this on May the 4th, happy May the 4th. And I'm not going to end this video saying May the 4th with you, because that's kind of cringe, in my opinion. That's just not interesting. Not a fan of that. Not a fan of that at all. But yeah, last time I'll say it. Thank you for watching. Fuck toxicity, and keep on being kings.
Yep.
That's it, yeah.